Leave it to Liz to have her priorities straight. I will explain, I promised. I know I'm a horrible friend for dragging you both into this, but please give me a moment. I need to concentrate. Concentrate on what? Emma demanded. Emma, hush, Liz chided. She said to let her concentrate. I closed my eyes, trying to calm my nerves. It wasn't easy, especially with an audience. Without my supplies, however, I was defenceless, and I wasn't likely to get another chance to retrieve them. I thought, you can do this, Sadie. It's only reaching into another dimension, only ripping a tear in the fabric of reality. I reached out. Nothing happened. I tried again, and my hand disappeared into the duat. Liz shrieked. Fortunately, I didn't lose my concentration or my hand. My fingers closed around the strap of my magic bag, and I pulled it free. Emma's eyes widened. That's brilliant. How did you do that? I was wondering the same thing, actually. Given the circumstances, I couldn't believe I'd managed it on just my second try. It's, magic, I said. My mates stared at me, mystified and scared, and the enormity of my problems suddenly came crashing down on me. A year ago, Liz, Emma and I would have been riding this train to Funland or the cinema. We would have been laughing at the ridiculous ringtones on Lizzie's phone or Emma's photoshopped pictures of the girls we hated at school. The most dangerous things in my life had been Gran's cooking and Gramps' temper when he saw my marks for the term. Now Gramps was a giant baboon. Gran was an evil vulture. My friends were regarding me as if I'd dropped from another planet, which wasn't far from the truth. Even with my magic supplies in hand, I had no idea what I was going to do. I didn't have the full power of Isis at my command anymore. If I tried to fight Bobby and Nekbet, I might injure my own grandparents and would likely get myself killed. But if I didn't stop them, who would? Godly possession would eventually burn out a human host. That had almost happened to Uncle Amos, who was a full-fledged magician and knew how to defend himself. Gran and Gramps were old, frail, and quite unmagical. They didn't have much time. Despair, much worse than the vulture goddess's wings, overwhelmed me. I didn't realize I was crying until Liz put her hand on my shoulder. Sadie, dear, we're sorry. It's just a bit strange, you know. Tell us what's the matter. Let us help. I took a shaky breath. I'd missed my mates so much. I'd always thought them a bit odd, but now they seemed blissfully normal, part of a world that wasn't mine anymore. They were both trying to act brave, but I could tell they were terrified inside. I wished I could leave them behind, hide them, keep them out of harm's way, but I remembered what Nekbet had said. They'll make lovely appetizers. Anubis had warned that the vulture goddess would hunt down my friends and hurt them just to hurt me. At least if they were with me, I could try to protect them. I didn't want to upend their lives the way mine had been, but I owed them the truth. This will sound absolutely mad, I warned. I gave them the shortest version possible. Why I'd left London, how the Egyptian gods had escaped into the world, how I'd discovered my ancestry as a magician. I told them about our fight with Set, the rise of Apophis, and our insane idea to awaken the god Ra. Two stations passed, but it felt so good to tell my friends the story that I rather lost track of time. When I was done, Liz and Emma looked at one another, no doubt wondering how to gently tell me I was bonkers. I know it seems impossible, I said, but Sadie, we believe you, Emma said. I blinked. You do? Course we do. Liz's face was flushed, the way she got after several roller coaster rides. I've never heard you talk so seriously about anything. You've changed. It's just I'm a magician now, and I can't believe how stupid that sounds. It's more than that. Emma studied my face as if I was turning into something quite frightening. You seem older, more mature. Her voice was tinged with sadness, and I realized my mates and I were growing apart. It was as if we stood on opposite sides of a widening chasm, and I knew with gloomy certainty the breach was already too wide for me to jump back across. "Your boyfriend is amazing," Liz added, probably to cheer me up. "He's not my..." I stopped. There was no winning that argument with Liz. Besides, I was so mixed up about that bloody Jackal Anubis, I didn't know where to begin. The train slowed. I saw the signs for Waterloo Station. "Oh, God," I said. "I meant to get off at London Bridge. I need a bridge." "Can't we backtrack?" Liz asked. A roar from the tunnel behind us answered that question. Looking back, I saw a large shape with glittering silver fur loping along the tracks. Its foot touched the third rail and sparks flew, but the baboon god lumbered on, unfazed. As the train braked, Bobby started to gain on us. "No going back," I said. "We'll have to make it to Waterloo Bridge." "That's half a mile from the station," Liz protested. "What if it catches us?" I rummaged through my bag and pulled out my new staff. Instantly, it expanded to full length, the lion-carved tip blazing with golden light. "Then I suppose we'll have to fight." Should I describe Waterloo Station as it was before or after we destroyed it? The main concourse was massive. It had a polished marble floor, loads of shops and kiosks, and a glass and girder ceiling high enough so that a helicopter could fly about inside comfortably. Rivers of people flowed in and out, mixing, separating, and occasionally colliding as they made their way to various escalators and platforms. When I was small, the station building had rather frightened me. I worried that the giant Victorian clock hanging from the ceiling might fall and crush me. The announcers' voices were much too loud. I prefer to be the noisiest thing in my environment, thank you very much. The masses of commuters standing mesmerised under the departure boards watching for their trains reminded me of a mob in a zombie movie, which, granted, I shouldn't have watched as a young child, but I was always rather precocious. At any rate, my mates and I were racing through the main station, pushing our way toward the nearest exit, when a stairwell behind us exploded. Crowds scattered as Bobby climbed from the rubble. Businessmen screamed, dropping their briefcases and sprinting for their lives. Liz, Emma and I pressed against the side of the paper chase kiosk to avoid getting trampled by a group of tourists yelling in Italian. Bobby howled. His fur was covered with grime and soot from his run through the tunnels. Gramps's cardigan was ripped to shreds on his arm, but miraculously, his glasses were still on his head. He sniffed the air, probably trying to catch my scent. Then a dark shadow passed overhead.
"Where are you going, Sadie Kane?"
Neckbet shrieked. She soared through the terminal, swooping down on the already panicked crowds.
"Would you fight by running away? You are not worthy!"
An announcer's calm voice echoed through the terminal. "The 8:02 train for Basingstoke will arrive on platform 3. Bobby swatted a bronze statue of some poor famous bloke and knocked his head clean off. A policeman ran forward, armed with a pistol. Before I could yell at him to stop, he fired a shot at Bobby. Liz and Emma both screamed. The bullet deflected off Bobby's fur as if it were made of titanium and shattered a nearby McDonald's sign. The officer fainted dead away. I'd never seen so many people clear out of a terminal so quickly. I considered following them, but decided it would be too dangerous. I couldn't have these insane gods killing loads of innocent people just because I was in their midst. And if we tried to join the Exodus, we'd only get stuck or crushed in a stampede. "Sadie, look!" Liz pointed up, and Emma yelped. Neckbet sailed into the ceiling girders and perched there with the pigeons. She glared down at us and cried to Bobby,
"Here she is, my dear, here!"
"I wish she'd shut up," I muttered.
"Isis was foolish to choose you!"
Neckbet yelled.
"I will feed on your entrails!"
said Bobby in hearty agreement.
"The 8:14 train for Brighton is delayed," said the announcer. "We apologise for the inconvenience."
Bobby had seen us now. His eyes smouldered with primal rage, but I also saw something of Gramps in his expression, the way he furrowed his brow and jutted out his chin, just as Gramps did when he got angry at the telly and yelled at the rugby players. Seeing that expression on the baboon god almost made me lose my nerve. I wasn't going to die here. I wasn't going to let these two repulsive gods hurt my friends or burn up my grandparents. Bobby lumbered toward us. Now that he'd found us, he didn't seem in a hurry to kill us. He lifted his head and made a deep barking sound to the left and right, as if calling out, summoning friends for dinner. Emma's fingers dug into my arm. Liz whimpered, "Sadie?" The crowds had mostly cleared out now. No other police were in sight. Perhaps they'd fled, or perhaps they were all on their way to Canary Wharf, not realizing the problem was now here. "We're not going to die," I promised my mates. "Emma, hold my staff. You're..." "Oh, right." She took the staff gingerly, as if I'd handed her a rocket launcher, which I suppose it could have been with the proper spell. "Liz," I ordered, "watch the baboon." "Watching the baboon," she said. "Rather hard to miss the baboon." I rummaged through my magic bag, desperately taking inventory. Wand, good for defence, but against two gods at once I needed more. Sons of Horus, magic chalk. This wasn't the place to draw a protective circle. I had to get to the bridge. I needed to buy time to get out of this terminal. "Sadie," Liz warned. Bobby had jumped onto the roof of the body shop. He roared, and smaller baboons began to appear from every direction, climbing over the heads of fleeing commuters, swinging down from the girders, popping out of the stairwells and shops. There were dozens of them, all wearing black and silver basketball jerseys. Was basketball some sort of international baboon sport? Until today, I'd been rather fond of baboons. The ones I'd met before, like Hufu and his sociable friends, were the sacred animals of Toth, god of knowledge. They were generally wise and helpful. I suspected, however, that Bobby's troop of baboons was a different sort altogether. They had blood-red fur, wild eyes, and fangs that would have made a saber-toothed tiger feel inadequate. They began to close in, snarling as they prepared to pounce. I pulled a block of wax from my bag, no time to fashion a sharpie, two tight amulets, the sacred mask of Isis. Ah, those might be helpful. Then I found a corked glass vial I'd quite forgotten about. Inside was some murky sludge, my first attempt at a potion. It had been sitting at the bottom of my bag for ages because I'd never been desperate enough to test it. I shook the potion. The liquid glowed with a sickly green light. Bits of gunk swirled inside. I uncorked it. The stuff smelled worse than neckbet. "What is that?" Liz asked. "Disgusting," I said. "Animation scroll blended with oil, water, and a few secret ingredients. Came out a bit chunky, I'm afraid." "Animation?" Emma asked. "You're going to summon cartoons?" "That would be brilliant," I admitted, "but this is more dangerous. If I do it right, I can ingest a great deal of magic without burning myself up."
"And if you do it wrong?" Liz asked.
I handed them each an amulet of Isis. "Hold on to these. When I say go, run for the taxi stands. Don't stop."
"Sadie," Emma protested,
"what on earth?"
Before I could lose my nerve, I gagged down the potion.
Above us, Neckbet cackled.
"Give up! You cannot oppose us!"
The shadow of her wings seemed to spread over the entire concourse, making the last of the commuters flee in panic and weighing me down with fear. I knew it was only a spell, but still the temptation to accept a quick death was almost overwhelming. A few of the baboons got distracted by the smell of food and raided the McDonald's. Several others were chasing a train conductor, beating him with rolled-up fashion magazines. Sadly, most of the baboons were still focused on us. They made a loose ring around the paper chase kiosk. From his command station atop the body shop, Bobby howled, a clear command to attack. Then the potion hit my gut. Magic coursed through my body. My mouth tasted like I'd swallowed a dead toad, but now I understood why potions were so popular with ancient magicians. The animation spell, which had taken me days to write and would normally take at least an hour to cast, was now tingling in my bloodstream. Power surged into my fingertips. My only problem was channeling the magic, making sure it didn't burn me to a crisp. I called on Isis as best I could, tapping her power to help me shape the enchantment. I envisioned what I wanted, and the right word of power popped into my head. Protect. Nanta. I released the magic. A gold hieroglyph burned in front of me. A wave of golden light rippled through the concourse. The troop of baboons hesitated. Bobby stumbled on the body shop roof. Even Neckbet squawked and faltered on the ceiling girders. All around the station, inanimate objects began to move. Backpacks and briefcases suddenly learned to fly. Magazine racks, gum, sweets, and assorted cold drinks exploded out of the shops and attacked the baboon troop. The decapitated bronze head from the statue shot out of nowhere and slammed into Bobby's chest, knocking him backward through the roof of the body shop. A tornado of pink Financial Times newspapers swirled toward the ceiling. They engulfed Neckbet, who stumbled blindly and fell shrieking from her perch in a flurry of pink and black. "Go!" I told my friends. We ran for the exit, weaving around baboons who were much too busy to stop us. One was being pummeled by a half-dozen bottles of sparkling water. Another was fending off a briefcase and several kamikaze blackberries. Bobby tried to rise, but a maelstrom of body shop products surged around him. Lotions, loofah sponges and shampoos all battering him, squirting in his eyes and trying to give him an extreme makeover. He bellowed in irritation, slipped and fell back into the ruined shop. I doubted my spell would do the gods any permanent damage, but with luck it would keep them occupied for a few minutes. Liz, Emma and I made it out of the terminal. With the entire station evacuated, I didn't really expect any cabs to be in the taxi queue, and indeed the curb was empty. I resigned myself to running all the way to Waterloo Bridge, though Emma had no shoes and the potion had made me queasy. "Look!" Liz said. "Oh, well done, Sadie," Emma said. "What?" I asked. "What did I do?" Then I noticed the chauffeur, an extremely short, scruffy man standing at the end of the drive in a black suit holding a placard that read, "Kane." I suppose my friends thought I'd summoned him by magic. Before I could tell them differently, Emma said, "Come on!" And they sprinted toward the little man. I had no choice but to follow. I remembered what Anubis had said about sending my driver to meet me. I supposed this must be him, but the closer we got, the less eager I was to meet him. He was shorter than me by half, stouter than my Uncle Amos, and uglier than anyone else on the planet. His facial features were positively Neanderthal. Under his thick, furry monobrow, one eye was bigger than the other. His beard looked as if it had been used to scrape greasy pots. His skin was poxy with red welts, and his hair looked like a bird's nest that had been set on fire, then stomped out. When he saw me, he scowled, which did nothing to help his appearance.
"About time."
His accent was American. He belched into his fist, and the smell of curry nearly knocked me over.
"Bast's friend, Sadie Kane?"
Possibly. I decided to have a serious talk with Bast about her choice of friends. "Just by the way, we have two gods trying to kill us." The warty little man smacked his lips, clearly unimpressed.
"Guess you'll want a bridge, then."
He turned toward the curb and yelled,
"Boo!"
A black Mercedes limousine appeared out of nowhere as if it had been scared into existence. The chauffeur glanced back at me and arched his brow.
"Well, get in."
I'd never been in a limousine before. I hope most are nicer than the one we took. The back seat was littered with takeaway curry containers, old fish and chip paper, crisp bags, and various dirty socks. Despite this, Emma, Liz and I crammed together in the back because none of us dared to ride up front. You may think I was mad to get in a car with a strange man. You're right, of course, but Bast had promised us help and Anubis had told me to expect a driver. The fact that our promised help was a little man with bad hygiene and a magical limousine did not particularly surprise me. I'd seen stranger things. Also, I didn't have much choice. The potion had worn off, and the strain of releasing so much magic had made me light-headed and wobbly-legged. I wasn't sure I could have walked to Waterloo Bridge without passing out. The chauffeur floored the gas and barreled out of the station. The police had cordoned it off, but our limo swerved around the barricades, past a cluster of BBC news vans and a mob of spectators, and no one paid us any attention. The chauffeur started whistling a tune that sounded like short people. His head barely reached the headrest.
All I could see of him was a grubby nest of hair and a set of furry hands on the wheel. Stuck in the sun visor was an identification card with his picture, sort of. It had been taken at point-blank range, showing only an out-of-focus nose and a hideous mouth, as if he'd been trying to eat the camera. The card read, "Your driver is Bess." "Your Bess, I guess?" I said.
"Yes," he said.
"Your car's a mess," Liz muttered.
"If one more person rhymes," Emma grumbled, "I'll throw up."
"Is it Mr. Bess?" I asked, trying to place his name from Egyptian mythology. I was fairly sure they hadn't had a god of chauffeurs.
"Lord Bess? Bess the extremely short?"
"Just Bess," he grunted. "One S. And no, it's not a girl's name. Call me Bessie and I'll have to kill you. As for being short, I am the dwarf god, so what do you expect? Oh, there's bottled water for you back there if you're thirsty."
I looked down. Rolling about at my feet were two partially empty bottles of water. One had lipstick on the cap, the other looked as if it had been chewed on.
"Not thirsty," I decided.
Liz and Emma murmured agreement. I was surprised they weren't absolutely catatonic after the evening's events, but then again, they were my mates. I didn't hang out with weak-willed girls, did I? Even before I discovered magic, it took a strong constitution and a fair amount of adaptability to be my friend. And no comment from you, Carter. Police vehicles were blocking Waterloo Bridge, but Bess swerved around them, jumped the pavement, and kept driving. The police didn't even blink.
"Are we invisible?" I asked.
"To most mortals," Bess belched. "They're pretty dense, aren't they? Present company accepted, etc."
"You're really a god?" Liz asked.
"Huge," Bess said. "I'm huge in the world of gods."
"A huge god of dwarves?" Emma marveled. "You mean as in Snow White or..."
"All dwarves."
Bess waved his hands expansively, which made me a bit nervous as he took both of them off the wheel.
"Egyptians were smart. They honored people who were born unusual. Dwarves were considered extremely magical. So yeah, I'm the god of dwarves."
Liz cleared her throat.
"Isn't there a more polite term we're supposed to use nowadays? Like little person, or vertically challenged, or..."
"I'm not going to call myself the god of vertically challenged people," Bess grumbled. "I'm a dwarf. Now, here we are, just in time."
He spun the car to a stop in the middle of the bridge. Looking behind us, I almost lost the contents of my stomach. A winged black shape was circling over the riverbank. At the end of the bridge, Bobby was taking care of the barricade in his own fashion. He was throwing police cars into the River Thames while the officers scattered and fired their weapons, though the bullets seemed to have no effect on the baboon god's steely fur.
"Why are we stopping?" Emma asked.
Bess stood on his seat and stretched, which he could do quite easily.
"It's a river," he said. "Good place to fight gods, if I do say so myself. All that force of nature flowing underneath our feet makes it hard to stay anchored in the mortal world."
Looking at him more closely, I could see what he meant. His face was shimmering like a mirage. A lump formed in my throat. This was the moment of truth. I felt sick from the potion and from fear. I wasn't at all sure I had enough magic to combat those two gods, but I had no choice.
"Liz, Emma," I said, "we're getting out."
"Getting out?" Liz whimpered. Emma swallowed.
"Are you sure?"
"I know you're scared," I said, "but you'll need to do exactly as I say." They nodded hesitantly and opened the car doors. The poor things. Again, I wished I'd left them behind, but honestly, after seeing my grandparents possessed, I couldn't stand the idea of letting my friends out of my sight. Bess stifled a yawn.
"Need my help?"
Bobby was lumbering toward us. Neckbet circled over him, shrieking orders. If the river was affecting them at all, they didn't show it. I didn't see how a dwarf god could stand against those two, but I said, "Yes, I need help."
"Right."
Bess cracked his knuckles.
"So, get out."
"What?"
"I can't change my clothes with you in the car, can I? I have to put on my ugly outfit."
"Ugly outfit?"
"Go," the dwarf commanded. "I'll be out in a minute."
It didn't take much encouragement. None of us wanted to see any more of Bess than we had to. We got out, and Bess locked the doors behind us. The windows were heavily tinted, so I couldn't see in. For all I knew, Bess would be relaxing, listening to music, while we got slaughtered. I certainly didn't have much hope that a wardrobe change was going to defeat Nekbet and Bobby. I looked at my frightened mates, then at the two gods charging toward us. "We'll make our last stand here." "Oh, no, no," Liz said. "I really don't like the term, last stand." I rummaged through my bag and took out a piece of chalk and the four sons of Horus. "Liz, put these statues at the cardinal points, north, south, and so on. Emma, take the chalk. Draw a circle connecting the statues. We only have a few seconds." I traded her chalk for my staff, then had a horrible flash of déjà vu. I'd just ordered my friends into action exactly as Zia Rashid had bossed me the first time we'd faced an enemy god together. I didn't want to be like Zia. On the other hand, I realized for the first time just how much courage she must have had to stand up to a goddess while protecting two complete novices. I hate to say it, but it gave me a newfound respect for her. I wished I had her bravery. I raised my staff and wand and tried to focus. Time seemed to slow down. I reached out with my senses until I was aware of everything around me. Emma scrawling with chalk to finish the circle, Lizzie's heart beating too fast, Bobby's massive feet pounding on the bridge as he ran toward us, the Thames flowing under the bridge, and the currents of the Duat flowing around me just as powerfully. Bast once told me the Duat was like an ocean of magic under the surface of the mortal world. If that was true, then this place, a bridge over moving water, was like a jet stream. Magic flowed more strongly here. It could drown the unwary. Even gods might be swept away. I tried to anchor myself by concentrating on the landscape around me. London was my city. From here I could see everything. The Houses of Parliament, the London Eye, even Cleopatra's Needle on the Victoria Embankment, where my mother had died. If I failed now, so close to where my mother had worked her last magic. No, I couldn't let it come to that. Bobby was only a meter away when Emma finished the circle. I touched my staff to the chalk and golden light flared up. The baboon god slammed into my protective force field like it was a metal wall. He staggered backward. Nekbet swerved away at the last second and flew around us, cawing in frustration. Unfortunately, the circle's light began to flicker. My mum had taught me at a very young age, for every action there is an equal and opposite reaction. That applied to magic as well as science. The force of Bobby's assault left me seeing black spots. If he attacked again, I wasn't sure I could hold the circle. I wondered if I should step outside it, make myself the target. If I channeled energy into the circle first, it might maintain itself for a while, even if I died. At least my friends would live. Zia Rashid had probably been thinking the same thing last Christmas when she stepped outside her circle to protect Carter and me. She really had been annoyingly brave. "Whatever happens to me," I told my friends, "stay inside the circle." "Sadie," Emma said, "I know that tone of voice. Whatever you're planning, don't." "You can't leave us," Liz pleaded. Then she shouted at Bobby in a squeaky voice, "Go away, you horrible foamy ape. My friend here doesn't want to destroy you, but she will." Bobby snarled. He was rather foamy, thanks to the body shop attack, and he smelled wonderful. Several different colours of shampoo foam and bath beads were matted in his silver fur. Nekbet hadn't fared so well. She perched atop a nearby lamppost, looking as if she'd been assaulted by the entire contents of the West Cornwall Pasty Company. Bits of ham, cheese and potato splattered her feathery cloak, giving testament to the brave enchanted meat pies that had given their brief lives to delay her. Her hair was decorated with plastic forks, napkins and bits of pink newsprint. She looked quite keen to tear me to shreds. The only good news? Bobby's minions evidently hadn't made it out of the train station. I imagined a troop of pasty-splattered baboons shoved against police cars and handcuffed. It lifted my spirits somewhat.
Neckbet snarled.
You surprised us at the station, Sadie Kane. I'll admit that was well done, and bringing us to this bridge. A good try, but we are not so weak. You don't have the strength to fight us any longer. If you cannot defeat us, you have no business raising Ra.
You lot should be helping me, I said, not trying to stop me.
Ugh, Bobby barked.
Indeed, agreed the vulture goddess. The strong survive without help. The weak must be killed and eaten. Which are you, child? Be honest.
The truth? I was about to drop. The bridge seemed to be spinning beneath me. Sirens wailed on both banks of the river. More police had arrived at the barricades, but for now they made no effort to advance. Bobby bared his fangs. He was so close I could smell his shampooed fur and his horrid breath. Then I looked at Gramps' glasses still stuck on his head, and all my anger came back. "Try me," I said. "I follow the path of Isis. Cross me and I'll destroy you!" I managed to light my staff. Bobby stepped back. Neckbet fluttered on her lamppost. Their forms shimmered briefly. The river was weakening them, loosening their connection to the mortal world like interference on a mobile phone line. But it wasn't enough. Neckbet must have seen the desperation in my face. She was a vulture. She specialized in knowing when her prey was finished.
A good last effort, child, she said, almost with appreciation. But you have nothing left. Bobby, attack!
The baboon god reared up on his back legs. I got ready to charge and deliver one final burst of energy to tap into my own life source and hopefully vaporize the gods. I had to make sure Liz and Emma survived. Then the limo's door opened behind me. Bess announced,
"No one is attacking anyone, except me, of course."
Neckbet shrieked in alarm. I turned to see what was going on. Immediately, I wished I could burn my eyes out of my head. Liz made a gagging sound.
Lord, no! That's wrong! Ugh!
Emma shouted in perfect baboon speak.
Make him stop!
Bess had indeed put on his ugly outfit. He climbed onto the roof of the limo and stood there, legs planted, arms akimbo, like Superman, except with only the underwear. For those faint of heart, I won't go into great detail, but Bess, all of a meter tall, was showing off his disgusting physique, his pot belly, hairy limbs, awful feet, gross flabby bits, and wearing only a blue Speedo. Imagine the worst-looking person you've ever seen on a public beach, the person for whom swimwear should be illegal. Bess looked worse than that. I wasn't sure what to say except,
"Put on some clothes!"
Bess laughed, the sort of guffaw that says,
"Ha ha, I'm amazing!" "Not until they leave," he said, "or I'll be forced to scare them back to the Duat."
"This is not your affair, dwarf god!"
Neckbet snarled, averting her eyes from his horribleness.
"Go away!"
"These children are under my protection," Bess insisted.
"I don't know you," I said. "I never met you before today."
"Nonsense! You expressly asked for my protection."
"I didn't ask for the Speedo Patrol." Bess leaped off the limo and landed in front of my circle, placing himself between Bobby and me. The dwarf was even more horrible from behind. His back was so hairy it looked like a mink coat. And on the back of his Speedo was printed Dwarf Pride. Bess and Bobby circled each other like wrestlers. The baboon god swiped at Bess, but the dwarf was agile. He scrambled up Bobby's chest and headbutted him in the nose. Bobby staggered backward as the dwarf continued pounding away, using his face as a deadly weapon. "Don't hurt him!" I yelled. "It's my Gramps in there!" Bobby slumped against the railing. He blinked, trying to regain his bearings, but Bess breathed on him, and the smell of curry must have been too much. The baboon's knees buckled. His body shimmered and began to shrink. He crumpled on the pavement and melted into a stocky, grey-haired pensioner in a tattered cardigan. Cramps! I couldn't stand it. I left the protective circle and ran to his side.
He'll be fine, Bess promised.
Then he turned toward the vulture goddess.
Now it's your turn, Neckbet. Leave!
I stole this body fair and square, she wailed. I like it in here.
You asked for it.
Bess rubbed his hands, took a deep breath, and did something I will never be able to erase from my memory. If I simply said he made a face and yelled boo, that would be technically correct, but it wouldn't begin to convey the horror. His head swelled, his jaw unhinged until his mouth was four times too big, his eyes bulged like grapefruits, his hair stuck straight up like Bast's. He shook his face and waggled his slimy green tongue and roared, "Boo!" So loudly the sound rolled across the Thames like a cannon shot. This blast of pure ugly blew the feathers off Neckbet's cloak and drained all the colour from her face. It ripped away the essence of the goddess like tissue paper in a storm. The only thing left was a dazed old woman in a flower print dress squatting on the lamppost. Oh dear, Gran fainted. Bess jumped up and caught her before she could topple into the river. The dwarf's face went back to normal, well, normally ugly, at least, as he eased Gran onto the pavement next to Gramps. Thank you, I told Bess. Now will you please put on some clothes? He gave me a toothy grin, which I could have lived without.
You're all right, Sadie Kane. I see why Bast likes you. Sadie?
My grandfather groaned, his eyelids fluttering open. I'm here, Gramps. I stroked his forehead. How do you feel?
Strange craving for mangoes.
He went cross-eyed.
And possibly insects. You saved us?
Not really, I admitted. My friend here...
Certainly she saved you,
Bess said.
Brave girl you have here. Quite a magician.
Gramps focused on Bess and scowled.
Bloody Egyptian gods in their bloody revealing swimwear. This is why we don't do magic.
I sighed with relief. Once Gramps started complaining, I knew he was going to be all right. Gran was still passed out, but her breathing seemed steady. The colour was coming back into her cheeks.
We should go, Bess said. The mortals are ready to storm the bridge.
I glanced toward the barricades and saw what he meant. An assault team was gathering, heavily armoured men with rifles, grenade launchers, and probably many other fun toys that could kill us. Liz, Emma, I called, help me with my grandparents. My friends ran over and started to help Gramps sit up, but Bess said,
They can't come.
What? I demanded. But you just said...
They're mortals, Bess said. They don't belong on your quest. If we're going to get the second scroll from Vlad Menshikov, we need to leave now.
You know about that? Then I remembered he'd spoken with Anubis.
Your grandparents and friends are in less danger here,
Bess said.
The police will question them, but they won't see old people and children as a threat.
We're not children, Emma grumbled.
Vultures, Gran whispered in her sleep. Meat pies.
Gramps coughed.
The dwarf is right, Sadie. Go. I'll be tip-top in a moment, though it's a pity that baboon chap couldn't leave me some of his power. I haven't felt that strong in ages.
I looked at my bedraggled grandparents and friends. My heart felt it was being stretched in more directions than Bessie's face. I realized the dwarf was right. They'd be safer here facing an assault team than going with us. And I realized, too, that they didn't belong on a magic quest. My grandparents had chosen long ago not to use their ancestral abilities, and my friends were just mortals. Brave, mad, ridiculous, wonderful mortals. But they couldn't go where I had to go. Sadie, it's fine. Emma adjusted her broken glasses and tried for a smile.
If we can handle the police, won't be the first time we've had to do some quick talking, eh?
We'll take care of your gran and gramps, Liz promised.
Don't need taking care of,
Gramps complained. Then he broke down in a fit of coughing.
Just go, my dear. That baboon god was in my head. I can tell you he means to destroy you. Finish your quest before he comes after you again. I couldn't even stop him. I couldn't.
He looked resentfully at his shaky old hands.
I never would have forgiven myself. Now off with you.
I'm sorry, I told them all. I didn't mean sorry,
Emma demanded.
Sadie Kane, that was the most brilliant birthday party ever. Now go.
She and Liz both hugged me, and before I could start crying, Bess shepherded me into the Mercedes. We drove north toward the Victoria Embankment. We were almost to the barricades when Bess slowed down.
What's wrong? I asked. Can't we go past invisibly?
It's not the mortals I'm worried about,
he pointed. All the police, reporters, and spectators around the barricades had fallen asleep. Several military types in body armor were curled on the pavement, cuddling their assault rifles like teddy bears. Standing in front of the barricades, blocking our car, were Carter and Walt. They were disheveled and breathing heavily, as if they'd run here all the way from Brooklyn. They both had wands at the ready. Carter stepped forward, pointing his sword at the windshield.
"Let her go," he yelled at Bess, "or I'll destroy you."
Bess glanced back at me.
"Should I frighten him?"
"No," I said. That was something I didn't need to see again. "I'll handle it." I stepped out of the limo. "Hello, boys. Brilliant timing." Walt and Carter frowned.
"You're not in danger?"
Walt asked me. "Not any more." Carter lowered his sword reluctantly.
"You mean the ugly guy?"
"He's a friend," I said. "Bast's friend. He's also our driver." Carter looked equal parts confused, annoyed, and uneasy, which made a satisfying ending to my birthday party.
"Driver to where?"
he asked. "Russia, of course," I said. "Hop in."
9. We get a vertically challenged tour of Russia. As usual, Sadie left out some important details, like how Walt and I nearly killed ourselves trying to find her. It wasn't fun, flying to the Brooklyn Museum. We had to hang from a rope under the griffin's belly like a couple of Tarzans, dodging policemen, emergency workers, city officials, and several old ladies who chased after us with umbrellas, screaming, "There's the hummingbird! Kill it!" Once we managed to open a portal, I wanted to take Freak through with us, but the gate of swirling sand kind of, well, freaked him out, so we had to leave him behind. When we got to London, television monitors in the storefronts were showing footage of Waterloo Station, something about a strange disturbance inside the terminal with escaped animals and windstorms. Gee, wonder who that could have been. We used Walt's amulet for Shu the air god to summon a burst of wind and jump to the Waterloo Bridge. Of course, we landed right in the middle of a heavily armed riot squad. Just luck that I remembered the sleep spell. Then, finally, we were ready to charge in and save Sadie, and she rides up in a limousine driven by an ugly dwarf in a swimsuit, and she accuses us of being late. So when she told us the dwarf was driving us to Russia, I was like, whatever, and I got into the car. The limousine drove through Westminster while Sadie, Walt, and I traded stories. After hearing what Sadie had been through, I didn't feel so bad about my day. A dream of Apophis and a three-headed snake in the training room didn't seem nearly as scary as gods taking over our grandparents. I'd never liked Gran and Gramps that much, but still, yikes. I also couldn't believe our chauffeur was Bess. Dad and I used to laugh about his pictures in museums, his bulging eyes, wagging tongue, and general lack of clothing. Supposedly, he could scare away almost anything. Spirits, demons, even other gods, which is why the Egyptian commoners had loved him. Bess looked out for the little guy. which wasn't meant as a dwarf joke. In the flesh, he looked exactly like his pictures, only in full color, with full smell. "We owe you," I told him. "So you're a friend of Bast's?" His ears turned red.
"Yeah, sure. She asks me for a favor once in a while. I try to help out."
I got the feeling there was some history there he didn't want to go into. "When Horace spoke to me," I said, "he warned that some of the gods might try to stop us from waking Ra. Now I guess we know who." Sadie exhaled.
"If they didn't like our plan, an angry text message would have done. Nekbet and Babi almost tore me apart."
Her face was a little green. Her combat boots were splattered with shampoo and mud, and her favorite leather jacket had a stain on the shoulder that looked suspiciously like vulture poop. Still, I was impressed that she was conscious. Potions are hard to make and even harder to use. There's always a price for channeling that much magic. "You did great," I told her. Sadie looked resentfully at the black knife in her lap, the ceremonial blade Anubis had given her.
"I'd be dead if not for Bess."
"Nah," Bess said. "Well, okay, you probably would be. But you would have gone down in style."
Sadie turned the strange black knife as if she might find instructions written on it.
"It's a Nijiri," I said. "A serpent blade. Priests used it for the opening of the mouth ceremony," she said. "But how does that help us?"
"Don't know," I admitted. "Bess?"
"Death rituals. I try to avoid them."
I looked at Walt. Magic items were his specialty, but he didn't seem to be paying attention. Ever since Sadie had told us about her talk with Anubis, Walt had been awfully quiet. He sat next to her, fidgeting with his rings.
"You okay?" I asked him.
"Yeah, just thinking." He glanced at Sadie. "About Nijiri blades, I mean." Sadie tugged at her hair like she was trying to make a curtain between her and Walt. The tension between them was so thick I doubted even a magic knife could cut through it.
"Bloody Anubis," she muttered. "I could have died for all he cared."
We drove in silence for a while after that. Finally, Bess turned onto Westminster Bridge and doubled back over the Thames. Sadie frowned.
"Where are we going? We need a portal. All the best artifacts are at the British Museum."
"Yeah," Bess said. "And the other magicians know that."
"Other magicians?" I asked.
"Kid, the House of Life has branches all over the world. London is the ninth gnome. With that stunt at Waterloo, Miss Sadie just sent up a big flare telling Desjardins' followers, 'Here I am!' You can bet they're going to be hunting you now. They'll be covering the museum in case you make a run for it. Fortunately, I know a different place we can open a portal."
Schooled by a dwarf. It should have occurred to me that London had other magicians. The House of Life was everywhere. Outside the security of Brooklyn House, there wasn't a single continent where we'd be safe. We rode through South London. The scene along Camberwell Road was almost as depressing as my thoughts. Rows of grubby brick apartments and low-rent shops lined the street. An old woman scowled at us from a bus stop. In the doorway of an Asda grocery store, a couple of young tough guys eyed the Mercedes as if they wanted to steal it. I wondered if they were gods or magicians in disguise, because most people didn't notice the car. I couldn't imagine where Bess was taking us. It didn't seem like the kind of neighborhood where you'd find a lot of Egyptian artifacts. Finally, a big park opened up on our left. Misty green fields, tree-lined paths, and a few ruined walls like aqueducts covered in vines. The land sloped upward to a hilltop with a radio tower. Bess jumped the curb and drove straight over the grass, knocking down a sign that said, "Keep to the path." The evening was gray and rainy, so there weren't many people around. A couple of joggers on the nearby path didn't even look at us, as if they saw Mercedes limos four-wheeling across the park every day. "Where are we going?" I asked.
Watch and learn, kid,
Bess said. Being called kid by a guy shorter than me was a little annoying, but I kept my mouth shut. Bess drove straight up the hill. Close to the top was a stone staircase, maybe 30 feet wide, built into the hillside. It seemed to lead nowhere. Bess slammed on the brakes and we swerved to a stop. The hill was higher than I'd realized. Spread out below us was the whole of London. Then I looked more closely at the staircase. Two sphinxes made of weathered stone lay on either side of the stairs, watching over the city. Each was about 10 feet long, with the typical lion's body and pharaoh's head, but they seemed totally out of place in a London park. Those aren't real, I said. Bess snorted.
Of course they're real.
I mean, they aren't from ancient Egypt. They're not old enough.
Picky, picky, Bess said. These are the stairs to the Crystal Palace. Big glass and steel exhibit hall the size of a cathedral used to sit right here on this hill.
Sadie frowned. I read about that in school. Queen Victoria had a party there, something.
A party or something?
Bess grunted.
It was the Grand Exhibition in 1851. Showcase of British Imperial Might, etc. They had good candied apples.
You were there? I asked. Bess shrugged.
The palace burned down in the 1930s, thanks to some stupid magicians. But that's another story. All that's left now are a few relics like these stairs and the sphinxes.
A stairway to nowhere, I said.
Not nowhere,
Bess corrected.
Tonight, it'll take us to St. Petersburg.
Walt sat forward. His interest in the statues had apparently shaken him out of his gloom.
But if the sphinxes aren't really Egyptian, he said, how can they open a portal?
Bess gave him a toothy grin.
Depends on what you mean by really Egyptian, kid. Every great empire is a wannabe Egypt. Having Egyptian stuff around makes them feel important. That's why you've got new Egyptian artifacts in Rome, Paris, London, you name it. That obelisk in Washington.
Don't mention that one, please, Sadie said.
Anyway,
Bess continued.
These are still Egyptian sphinxes. They were built to play up the connection between the British Empire and the Egyptian Empire. So yeah, they can channel magic, especially if I'm driving. And now,
he looked at Walt,
it's probably time for you to get out.
I was too surprised to say anything, but Walt stared at his lap as if he'd been expecting this.
Hang on, Sadie said. Why can't Walt come with us? He's a magician. He can help.
Bess's expression turned serious.
Walt, you haven't told them.
Told us what?
Sadie demanded. Walt clutched his amulets as if there might be one that would help him avoid this conversation.
It's nothing, really. It's just, I should help out at Brooklyn House. And Jazz thought...
He faltered, probably realizing that he shouldn't have brought up her name.
Yes.
Sadie's tone was dangerously calm.
How's Jazz doing?
She's still in a coma, Walt said. Amos says she'll probably make it, but that's not what I...
Good, Sadie said. Glad she'll get better. So you need to get back, then. That's brilliant. Off you go. Anubis said we should hurry.
Not very subtle, the way she threw his name out there. Walt looked like she'd kicked him in the chest. I knew Sadie wasn't being fair to him. From my conversation with Walt back at Brooklyn House, I knew he liked Sadie. Whatever was bothering him, it wasn't any kind of romantic thing with Jazz. On the other hand, if I tried to take his side, Sadie would just tell me to butt out. I might even make things worse between Sadie and him.
It's not that I want to go back, he managed.
But you can't go with us,
Bess said firmly. I thought I heard concern in his voice, even pity.
Go on, kid. It's fine.
Walt fished something out of his pocket.
Sadie, about your birthday. You, probably don't want any more presents. It's not a magic knife, but I made this for you.
He poured a gold necklace into her hand. It had a small Egyptian symbol.
That's the basketball hoop on Ra's head, I said.
Walt and Sadie both frowned at me, and I realized I probably wasn't making the moment more magical for them.
I mean, it's the symbol that surrounds Ra's sun crown, I said. A never-ending loop. The symbol of eternity, right?
Sadie swallowed as if the magic potion was still bubbling in her stomach.
Eternity.
Walt shot me a look that clearly meant, please stop helping.
Yeah, he said. It's called Shen. I just thought, you know, you're looking for Ra, and good things, important things, should be eternal. So maybe it'll bring you luck. I meant to give it to you this morning, but I kind of lost my nerve.
Sadie stared at the talisman glittering in her palm.
Walt, thank you, but...
Just remember, I didn't want to leave, he said. If you need help, I'll be there for you.
He glanced at me and corrected himself.
I mean both of you, of course.
But now, Bess said, you need to go.
Happy birthday, Sadie, Walt said, and good luck.
He got out of the car and trudged down the hill. We watched until he was just a tiny figure in the gloom. Then he vanished into the woods.
Two farewell gifts, Sadie muttered, from two gorgeous guys. I hate my life.
She latched the gold necklace around her throat and touched the Shen symbol. Bess gazed down at the trees where Walt had disappeared.
Poor kid. Born unusual, all right. It isn't fair.
What do you mean? I asked. Why were you so anxious for Walt to leave? The dwarf rubbed his scraggly beard.
Not my place to explain. Right now we've got work to do. The more time we give Menshikov to prepare his defenses, the harder this is going to get.
I wasn't ready to drop it, but Bess stared at me stubbornly, and I knew I wasn't going to get any more answers from him. Nobody can look stubborn like a dwarf.
So, Russia, I said, by driving up an empty staircase.
Exactly.
Bess floored the accelerator. The Mercedes churned grass and mud and barreled up the stairs. I was sure we'd reach the top and get nothing but a broken axle, but at the last second, a portal of swirling sand opened in front of us. Our wheels left the ground, and the black limousine flew headlong into the vortex. We slammed into pavement on the other side, scattering a group of surprised teenagers. Sadie groaned and pried her head off the headrest.
"Can't we go anywhere gently?" she asked.
Bess hit the wipers and scraped the sand off our windshield. Outside, it was dark and snowy. 18th-century stone buildings lined a frozen river lit with street lamps. Beyond the river glowed more fairy tale buildings. Golden church domes, white palaces, and ornate mansions painted Easter egg green and blue. I might have believed we'd traveled back in time 300 years, except for the cars, the electric lights, and of course the teenagers with body piercings, dyed hair, and black leather clothes, screaming at us in Russian and pounding on the hood of the Mercedes because we'd almost run them over.
They can see us? Sadie asked.
Russians! Bess said with a kind of grudging admiration. Very superstitious people. They tend to see magic for what it is. We'll have to be careful here.
You've been here before? I asked. He gave me a duh look, then pointed to either side of the car. We'd landed between two stone sphinxes standing on pedestals. They looked like a lot of sphinxes I'd seen, with crowned human heads on lion bodies, but I'd never seen sphinxes covered in snow.
Are those authentic? I asked.
Farthest north Egyptian artifacts in the world, Bess said. pillaged from Thebes, and brought up here to decorate Russia's new imperial city, St. Petersburg. Like I said, every new empire wants a piece of Egypt.
The kids outside were still shouting and banging on the car. One smashed a bottle against our windshield. Sadie said, should we move?
Nah, Bess said. Russian kids always hang out by the Sphinxes. Been doing it for hundreds of years.
But it's like midnight here, I said, and it's snowing.
Did I mention they're Russian?
Bess said.
Don't worry, I'll take care of it.
He opened his door. Glacier-cold wind swept into the Mercedes, but Bess stepped out wearing nothing but his Speedo. The kids backed up quickly. I couldn't blame them. Bess said something in Russian, then roared like a lion. The kids screamed and ran. Bess's form seemed to ripple. When he got back into the car, he was wearing a warm winter coat, a fur-lined hat, and fuzzy mittens.
See? He said. Superstitious. They know enough to run from a god.
A small hairy god in a Speedo, yes, Sadie said. So what do we do now?
Bess pointed across the river at a glowing palace of white and gold stone.
That's the Hermitage.
Hermits live there? Sadie asked.
No, I said. I've heard of that place. It was the Tsar's palace. Now it's a museum. Best Egyptian collection in Russia.
Dad took you there, I suppose? Sadie asked.
I thought we were over the whole jealous about traveling the world with Dad thing, but every once in a while it cropped up again. We never went. I tried not to sound defensive. He got an invitation to speak there once, but he declined. Bess chuckled.
Your dad was smart. Russian magicians don't exactly welcome outsiders. They protect their territory fiercely.
Sadie stared across the river.
You mean the headquarters of the 18th gnome is inside the museum?
Somewhere, Bess agreed. But it's hidden with magic because I've never found the entrance. That part you're looking at is the Winter Palace, the old home of the Tsar. There's a whole complex of other mansions behind it. I've heard it would take 11 days just to see everything in all the Hermitage collections.
But unless we wake Ra, the world ends in 4 days, I said.
3 days now, Sadie corrected, if it's after midnight.
I winced. Thanks for the reminder.
So take the abbreviated tour, Bess said. Start with the Egyptian section. Ground floor, main museum.
Aren't you coming with us? I asked.
He can't, can he? Sadie guessed. Like Bast couldn't enter Desjardins' house in Paris. The magicians charm their headquarters against the gods. Isn't that right?
Bess made an even uglier face.
I'll walk you down to the bridge, but I can't go any farther. If I cross the river Neva too close to the Hermitage, I'll set off all kinds of alarms. You'll have to sneak inside somehow.
Breaking into a museum at night, Sadie muttered. We've had such good luck with that.
And find the entrance to the 18th gnome. And don't get captured alive.
What do you mean? I asked. It's better to be captured dead? The look in his eyes was grim.
Just trust me. You don't want to be Menshikov's prisoner.
Bess snapped his fingers, and suddenly we were wearing fleece parkas, ski pants, and winter boots.
Come on, Malishi, he said. I'll walk you to the Dvortsovoye Bridge.
The bridge was only a few hundred yards away, but it seemed farther. March obviously wasn't springtime in St. Petersburg. The dark, the wind, and the snow made it feel more like January in Alaska. Personally, I would have preferred a sweltering day in the Egyptian desert. Even with the warm clothes Bess had summoned for us, my teeth couldn't stop chattering. Bess wasn't in a hurry. He kept slowing down and giving us the guided tour until I thought my nose would fall off from frostbite. He told us we were on Vasilyevsky Island, across the Neva River from the center of St. Petersburg. He pointed out the different church spires and monuments, and when he got excited, he started slipping into Russian.
You spent a lot of time here, I said.
He walked in silence for a few paces.
Most of that was long ago. It wasn't...
He stopped so abruptly, I stumbled into him. He stared across the street at a big palace with canary yellow walls and a green gabled roof. Lit up in the night through a swirl of snow, it looked unreal, like one of the ghostly images in the first gnome's Hall of Ages.
Prince Menshikov's palace,
Bess muttered. His voice was full of loathing. I almost thought he was going to yell boo at the building, but he just gritted his teeth. Sadie looked at me for an explanation, but I wasn't a walking Wikipedia like she seemed to think. I knew stuff about Egypt, but Russia? Not so much.
You mean Menshikov? As in Vlad the Inhaler? I asked.
He's a descendant.
Bess curled his lip with distaste. He said a Russian word I was willing to bet was a pretty bad insult.
Back in the 1700s, Prince Menshikov threw a party for Peter the Great, the Tsar who built this city. Peter loved dwarves. He was a lot like the Egyptians that way. He thought we were good luck, so he always kept some of us in his court. Anyway, Menshikov wanted to entertain the Tsar, so he thought it would be funny to stage a dwarf wedding. He forced us, to dress up, pretend to get married, and dance around. All the big folk were laughing, jeering.
His voice trailed off. Bess described the party like it was yesterday. Then I remembered that this weird little guy was a god. He'd been around for eons. Sadie put her hand on his shoulder.
I'm sorry, Bess. Must have been awful.
He scowled.
Russian magicians. They love capturing gods, using us. I can still hear that wedding music and the Tsar laughing.
How'd you get away? I asked. Bess glared at me. Obviously, I'd asked a bad question.
Enough of this. Bess turned up his collar. We're wasting time.
He forged ahead, but I got the feeling he wasn't really leaving Menshikov's palace behind. Suddenly, its cheery yellow walls and brightly lit windows looked sinister. Another 100 yards through the bitter wind, and we reached the bridge. On the other side, the Winter Palace shimmered.
I'll take the Mercedes the long way around, Bess said. Down to the next bridge and circle south of the Hermitage. Less likely to alert the magicians that I'm here.
Now I realized why he was so paranoid about setting off alarms. Magicians had snared him in St. Petersburg once before. I remembered what he'd told us in the car. Don't get captured alive.
How do we find you if we succeed? Sadie asked.
When you succeed,
Bess said.
Think positive, girl, or the world ends.
Right.
Sadie shivered in her new parka.
Positive.
I'll meet you on the Nevsky Prospect, the main street with all the shops just south of the Hermitage. I'll be at the Chocolate Museum.
The what now? I asked.
Well, it's not really a museum, more of a shop. Closed this time of night, but the owner always opens up for me. They've got chocolate everything. Chess sets, lions, Vladimir Lenin heads.
The communist guy? I asked.
Yes, Professor Brilliant, Bess said. The communist guy in chocolate.
So, let me get this straight, Sadie said. We break into a heavily guarded Russian National Museum, find the magician's secret headquarters, find a dangerous scroll, and escape. Meanwhile, you will be eating chocolate.
Bess nodded solemnly.
It's a good plan. It might work. If something happens and I can't meet you at the Chocolate Museum, our exit point is the Egyptian Bridge to the south at the Fontanka River. Just turn on the...
Enough!
Sadie said.
You will meet us at the chocolate shop, and you will provide me with a takeaway bag. That is final. Now go.
Bess gave her a lopsided smile.
You're okay, girl.
He trudged back toward the Mercedes. I looked across the half-frozen river to the Winter Palace. Somehow, London didn't seem as dreary or dangerous anymore.
Are we in as much trouble as I think? I asked Sadie.
More, she said. Let's go crash the Tsar's palace, shall we?
10. An old red friend comes to visit. Getting inside the Hermitage wasn't a problem. State-of-the-art security doesn't protect against magic. Sadie and I had to combine forces to get past the perimeter, but with a little concentration, ink and papyrus, and some tapped energy from our godly friends Isis and Horus, we managed to pull off a short stroll through the Duat. 1 minute we were standing in the abandoned palace square. Then everything went gray and misty. My stomach tingled like I was in free fall. We slipped out of sync with the mortal world and passed through the iron gates and solid stone into the museum. The Egyptian room was on the ground floor, just as Bess had said. We re-entered the mortal realm and found ourselves in the middle of the collection. Sarcophagi and glass cases, hieroglyphic scrolls, statues of gods and pharaohs. It wasn't much different from 100 other Egyptian collections I'd seen, but the setting was pretty impressive. A vaulted ceiling soared overhead. The polished marble floor was done in a white and gray diamond pattern, which made walking on it kind of like walking on an optical illusion. I wondered how many rooms there were like this in the Tsar's palace, and if it really took 11 days to see them all. I hoped Bess was right about the secret entrance to the gnome being somewhere in this room. We didn't have 11 days to search. In less than 72 hours, Apophis would break free. I remembered that glowing red eye beneath the scarab shells, a force of chaos so powerful it could melt human senses. 3 days, and that thing would be unleashed on the world. Sadie summoned her staff and pointed it at the nearest security camera. The lens cracked and made a sound like a bug zapper. Even in the best of situations, technology and magic don't get along. One of the easiest spells in the world is to make electronics malfunction. I just have to look at a cell phone funny to make it blow up. And computers? Forget about it. I imagined Sadie had just sent a magical pulse through the security system that would fry every camera and sensor in the network. Still, there were other kinds of surveillance, magical kinds. I pulled a piece of black linen and a pair of crude wax shabti out of my bag. I wrapped the shabti in the cloth and spoke a command word. Imun. The hieroglyph for hide glowed briefly over the cloth. A mass of darkness bloomed from the package, like a squid's ink cloud. It expanded until it covered both Sadie and me in a gauzy bubble of shadows. We could see through it, but hopefully nothing could see in. The cloud would be invisible to anyone outside.
You got it right this time, Sadie said. When did you master the spell?
I probably blushed. I'd been obsessed with figuring out the invisibility spell for months, ever since I'd seen Zia use it in the first gnome. Well, actually, I'm still... A gold spark shot out of the cloud like a miniature fireworks rocket. I'm still working on it. Sadie sighed.
Well, better than last time. The cloud looked like a lava lamp, and the time before, when it smelled like rotten eggs, could we just get going? I asked. Where should we start?
Her eyes locked on one of the displays. She drifted toward it in a trance.
Sadie?
I followed her to a limestone grave marker, a stela, about 2 feet by 3 feet. The description next to it was in Russian and English. From the tomb of the scribe Ippi, I read aloud, worked in the court of King Tut. Why are you interested?
Oh.
Stupid me. The picture on the gravestone showed the deceased scribe honoring Anubis. After talking with Anubis in person, Sadie must have found it strange to see him in a 3,000-year-old tomb painting, especially when he was pictured with the head of a jackal, wearing a skirt. Walt likes you. I have no idea why I blurted that out. This wasn't the time or the place. I knew I wasn't doing Walt any favors by taking his side, but I'd started to feel bad for him after Bess kicked him out of the limo. The guy had come all the way to London to help me save Sadie, and we dumped him in Crystal Palace Park like an unwanted hitchhiker. I was kind of angry at Sadie for giving him the cold shoulder and crushing so hard on Anubis, who was 5,000 years too old for her and not even human. Plus, the way she snubbed Walt reminded me too much of the way Zia had treated me at first. And maybe, if I was honest with myself, I was also irritated with Sadie because she'd solved her own problems in London without needing our help. Wow. That sounded really selfish. But I suppose it was true. Amazing how many different ways a younger sister can annoy you at once. Sadie didn't take her eyes off the stela.
Carter, you have no idea what you're talking about.
You're not giving the guy a chance, I insisted. Whatever's going on with him, it's got nothing to do with you.
Very reassuring, but that's not... Besides, Anubis is a god. You don't honestly think... Carter!
She snapped. My cloaking spell must have been sensitive to emotion because another gold spark whistled and popped from our not-so-invisible cloud.
I wasn't looking at this stone because of Anubis.
You weren't?
No. And I'm certainly not having an argument with you about Walt. Contrary to what you might think, I don't spend every waking hour thinking about boys.
Just most waking hours? She rolled her eyes.
Look at the gravestone, bird brain. It's got a border around it, like a window frame or...
A door, I said. It's a false door. Lots of tombs had those. It was like a symbolic gateway for the dead person's ba, so it could go back and forth from the duat. Sadie pulled her wand and traced the edges of the stela.
This bloke, Ippy, was a scribe, which was another word for magician. He could have been one of us.
So?
So maybe that's why the stone is glowing, Carter. What if this false door's not false?
I looked at the stela more closely, but I didn't see any glow. I thought maybe Sadie was hallucinating from exhaustion or too much potion in her system. Then she touched her wand to the center of the stela and spoke the first command word we'd ever learned.
Whippe!
Open. A golden hieroglyph burned on the stone. The grave marker shot out a beam of light like a movie projector. Suddenly, a full-size doorway shimmered in front of us, a rectangular portal showing the hazy image of another room. I looked at Sadie in amazement.
How did you do that?
I asked. You've never been able to do that before. She shrugged as if it were no big deal.
I wasn't 13 before. Maybe that's it.
But I'm 14, I protested, and I still can't do that.
Girls mature earlier.
I gritted my teeth. I hated the spring months. March, April, May, because until my birthday rolled around in June, Sadie could claim to be only a year younger than me. She always got an attitude after her birthday, as if she'd catch up to me somehow and become my big sister. Talk about a nightmare. She gestured at the glowing doorway.
After you, brother dear. You're the one with the sparkly invisibility cloud.
Before I could lose my cool, I stepped through the portal. I almost fell and broke my face. The other side of the portal was a mirror hanging 5 feet off the floor. I'd stepped onto a fireplace mantle. I caught Sadie as she came through, just in time to keep her from toppling off the ledge.
Ta, she whispered. Someone's been reading too much Alice through the looking glass.
I thought the Egyptian room was impressive, but it was nothing compared to this ballroom. Coppery geometric designs glittered on the ceiling. The walls were lined with dark green columns and gilded doors. White and gold inlaid marble made a huge octagonal pattern on the floor. With a blazing chandelier above, the golden filigree and green and white polished stone gleamed so brightly they hurt my eyes. Then I realized most of the light wasn't coming from the chandelier. It was coming from the magician casting a spell at the other end of the room. His back was turned, but I could tell it was Vlad Menshikov. Just as Sadie had described, he was a pudgy little man with curly gray hair and a white suit. He stood in a protective circle that pulsed with emerald light. He raised his staff, and the tip burned like a welding torch. To his right, just outside the circle, stood a green vase the size of a grown man. To his left, writhing in glowing chains, was a creature I recognized as a demon. It had a hairy humanoid body with purplish skin, but instead of a head, a giant corkscrew sprouted between its shoulders.
Mercy!
It screamed in a watery, metallic voice. Don't ask me how a demon could scream with a corkscrew head, but the sound resonated up the screw like it was a massive tuning fork. Vlad Menshikov kept chanting. The green vase throbbed with light. Sadie nudged me and whispered,
Look.
Yeah, I whispered back, some kind of summoning ritual.
No,
she hissed.
Look there.
She pointed to our right. In the corner of the room, 20 feet from the fireplace mantel, was an old-fashioned mahogany desk. Sadie had told me about Anubis's instructions. We were supposed to find Menshikov's desk. The next section of the Book of Ra would be in the middle drawer. Could that really be the desk? It seemed too easy. As quietly as we could, Sadie and I climbed off the mantel and crept along the wall. I prayed the invisibility shroud wouldn't send up any more fireworks. We were about halfway to the desk when Vlad Menshikov finished his chant. He slammed his staff against the floor, and it stuck there, straight up, the tip still burning at 1,000,000 degrees. He turned his head slightly, and I caught the glint of his white sunglasses. He rummaged in his coat pockets while the big green vase glowed, and the demon screamed in his chains.
Don't fuss, death to corks,
Menshikov chided. His voice was even rougher than Sadie had described, like a heavy smoker talking through the blades of a fan.
You know I need a sacrifice to summon such a major god. It's nothing personal.
Sadie frowned at me and mouthed, Major God? I shook my head, baffled. The House of Life didn't allow mortals to summon gods. It was the main reason Desjardins hated us. Menshikov was supposedly his best bud, so what was he doing, breaking the rules?
Hurts, the poor demon wailed. Served you for 50 years, master. Please.
Now,
Menshikov said without a trace of sympathy.
I have to use execration. Only the most painful form of banishment will generate enough energy.
From his suit coat pocket, Menshikov pulled a regular corkscrew and a shard of pottery covered with red hieroglyphics. He held up both items and began to chant again.
I name you, Death to Corks, servant of Vladimir, he who turns in the night.
As the demon's names were spoken, the magical chains steamed and tightened around his body. Menshikov held the corkscrew over the flame of his staff. The demon thrashed and wailed. As the smaller corkscrew turned red hot, the demon's body began to smoke. I watched in horror. I knew about sympathetic magic, of course. The idea was to make something small affect something large by binding them together. The more alike the items were, like the corkscrew and the demon, the easier they were to bind. Voodoo dolls worked on the same theory. But execration was serious stuff. It meant destroying a creature utterly, erasing its physical form and even its name from existence. It took some serious magic to pull off that kind of spell. If done wrong, it could destroy the caster. But if done right, most victims didn't stand a chance. Regular mortals, magicians, ghosts, even demons could be wiped off the face of the earth. Execration might not destroy major powers like gods, but it would still be like detonating a nuclear bomb in their face. They'd be blasted so deep into the Duat, they might never come back. Vlad Menshikov worked the spell like he did it every day. He kept chanting as the corkscrew began to melt, and the demon melted with it. Menshikov dropped the pottery shard on the floor, the red hieroglyphs that spelled all the demon's various names. With one final word of power, Menshikov stepped on the shard and crushed it to bits. Death to corks dissolved, chains and all. Usually I don't feel sorry for creatures of the underworld, but I couldn't help getting a lump in my throat. I couldn't believe the casual way Menshikov had snuffed out his servant just to power a larger spell. As soon as the demon was gone, the fire on Menshikov's staff died. Hieroglyphs burned around the summoning circle. The big green jar trembled, and a voice from deep inside boomed,
"Hello, Vladimir. Long time."
Sadie inhaled sharply. I had to cover her mouth to keep her from screaming. We both knew that voice. I remembered it all too well from the Red Pyramid.
"Set."
Menshikov didn't even look tired from the summoning. He sounded awfully calm for someone addressing the god of evil.
"We need to talk."
Sadie pushed my hand away and whispered,
"Is he mad?"
"Desk," I said. "Scroll. Out of here, now." For once, she gave me no argument. She began fishing supplies out of her bag. Meanwhile, the big green jar wobbled as if Set were trying to tip it over.
"A malachite vase." The god sounded annoyed. "Really, Vladimir, I thought we were on friendlier terms than that."
Menshikov's laugh sounded like someone choking a cat.
"Excellent at constraining evil spirits, isn't it? And this room has more malachite than any other place on Earth. Empress Alexandra was quite wise to have it built for her drawing room."
The jar plinked.
"But it smells like old pennies in here, and it's much too cold. Have you ever been stuck in a malachite jar, Vlad? I'm not a genie. I'd be so much more talkative if we could sit face to face. Perhaps over tea."
"I'm afraid not," said Menshikov. "Now you'll answer my questions."
"Oh, very well," Set said. "I like Brazil for the World Cup. I'd advise investing in platinum and small cap funds. And your lucky numbers this week are 2, 13.
"Not those questions,"
Menshikov snapped. Sadie pulled a lump of wax from her bag and worked furiously, fashioning some kind of animal shape. I knew she was going to test the desk for magic defenses. She was better at that kind of spell than I was, but I wasn't sure how she'd do it. Egyptian magic is pretty open-ended. There are always 1,000 different ways to accomplish a task. The trick is being creative with your supplies and picking a way that won't get you killed.
"You will tell me what I need to know,"
Menshikov demanded,
"or that jar will become even more uncomfortable."
"My dear Vladimir,"
Set's voice was full of evil amusement,
"what you need to know may be very different from what you want to know. Didn't your unfortunate accident teach you that?"
Menshikov touched his sunglasses as if making sure they hadn't fallen off.
"You will tell me the binding for Apophis,"
he said in a steely tone.
Then you will tell me how to neutralize the enchantments on Brooklyn House. You know Kane's defenses better than anyone. Once I destroy him, I will have no opposition.
As the meaning of Menshikov's words sank in, a wave of rage nearly knocked me off my feet. This time, Sadie had to clamp my mouth shut.
Calm, she whispered. You're going to start the invisibility shield popping again.
I pushed her hand away and hissed,
but he wants to free Apophis. I know. And attack Amos. I know. So help me get the bloody scroll and let's get out of here.
She put her wax animal on the desk. A dog, I thought, and began writing hieroglyphs on its back with a stylus. I took a shaky breath. Sadie was right, but still, Menshikov was talking about freeing Apophis and killing our uncle. What kind of magician makes deals with Set? Except for Sadie and me. That was different. Set's laugh echoed inside the green vase.
So, the binding for Apophis and the secrets of Brooklyn House. Is that all, Vladimir? I wonder what your master, Desjardins, would think if he found out your real plan and the sort of friends you keep.
Menshikov snatched up his staff. The carved serpent tip flared again.
Be careful with your threats, evil day.
The jar trembled. Throughout the room, glass cases shivered. The chandelier jangled like a 3-ton wind chime. I gave Sadie a panicked look. Did he just...
Set secret name, she confirmed,
still writing on her wax dog.
How? I don't know, Carter. Now shh!
A god's secret name had all kinds of power. It was supposed to be almost impossible to get. To truly learn it, you couldn't just hear it repeated by some random person. You had to hear it straight from the god himself or from the person closest to his heart. Once you had it, it gave you serious magical leverage over that god. Sadie had learned Set's secret name during our quest last Christmas, but how had Menshikov gotten it? Inside the jar, Set growled with annoyance.
I really hate that name. Why couldn't it have been Glorious Day or the Rockin' Red Reaper? That's rather nice. Bad enough when you were the only one who knew it, Vlad. Now I've got the Kane girl to worry about.
Serve us,
Menshikov said,
and the Kanes will be destroyed. You will be the honored lieutenant of Apophis. You can raise another temple, even grander than the Red Pyramid.
Aha, Set said. Maybe you haven't noticed, but I don't do well with the whole second-in-command concept. As for Apophis, he's not one to suffer other gods getting attention.
We will free Apophis with or without your help,
Menshikov warned.
By the equinox, he will rise. But if you help us make that happen sooner, you will be rewarded. Your other option is execration. Oh, I know it won't destroy you completely. But with your secret name, I can send you into the abyss for eons. And it will be very, very painful. I'll give you 30 seconds to decide.
I nudged Sadie. Hurry! She tapped the wax dog, and it came to life. It started sniffing around the desk, looking for magic traps. Inside the jar, Set sighed.
Well, Vladimir, you do know how to make an appealing offer. The binding for Apophis, you say? Yes. I was there when Ra cast the serpent into that prison of scarabs. I suppose I could remember the ingredients he used for the binding. Quite a day that was. I was wearing red, I think. At the victory feast, they served the most delicious honey-baked locusts.
You have 10 seconds,
Menshikov said. Oh, I'll cooperate. I hope you have a pen and paper handy. It's a rather long list of ingredients. Let's see. What did Ra use for a base?
Bat dung?
Then there were the dried toads, of course. And then...
Set began rattling off ingredients while Sadie's wax dog sniffed around the desk. Finally, it lay down on the blotter and went to sleep. Sadie frowned at me.
No traps.
That's too easy, I whispered back. She opened the top drawer. There was the papyrus scroll, just like the one we'd found in Brooklyn. She slipped it into her bag. We were halfway back to the fireplace when Set caught us by surprise. He was going on with his list of ridiculous ingredients.
And snake skins, yes, 3 large ones, with a sprinkling of hot sauce.
Then he stopped abruptly, like he'd had a revelation. He spoke in a much louder voice, calling across the room.
And a sacrificial victim would be good. Maybe a young idiot magician who can't do a proper invisibility spell, like Carter Kane over there.
I froze. Vladimir Menshikov turned, and my panic became too much for the invisibility shroud. 6 golden sparks shot up with a loud, happy whee! The cloud of darkness dissolved. Menshikov stared right at me.
My, my. How kind of you to deliver yourselves. Well done, Set.
Hmm? Set asked innocently.
Do we have visitors?
Set, Sadie growled. I'll kick you in the bar for that, so help me.
The voice in the jar gasped.
Sadie Kane, how exciting. Too bad I'm stuck in this jar. And no one will let me out.
The hint wasn't too subtle, but surely he couldn't believe we'd free him after he'd blown our cover. Sadie faced Menshikov, her wand and staff ready.
You're working with Apophis. You're on the wrong side.
Menshikov removed his glasses. His eyes were ruined pits of scar tissue, burned skin, and glistening corneas. Believe me, that is the least gross way I can describe them.
The wrong side, Menshikov asked. Girl, you have no idea the powers that are in play. 5,000 years ago, Egyptian priests prophesied how the world would end. Ra would grow old and tired, and Apophis would swallow him and plunge the world into darkness. Chaos would rule forever. Now the time is here. You can't stop it. You can only choose whether you'll be destroyed or whether you'll bow to the power of chaos and survive.
Right. Set chimed in. It's too bad I'm stuck in this jar. Otherwise, I might have to take sides and help someone.
Shut up, Set, Menshikov snapped. No one is crazy enough to trust you. And as for you children, you are clearly not the threat I imagined.
Great, I said. So we can go? Menshikov laughed.
Would you run to Desjardins and tell him what you've heard? He wouldn't believe you. He'd put you on trial, then execute you. But I'll spare you that embarrassment. I'll kill you right now.
How fun, Set said. Wish I could see it, but I'm stuck in this jar.
I tried to think. Menshikov was still inside a protective circle, which meant he had a big defensive advantage. I wasn't sure I could bust through it, even if I could summon a combat avatar. Meanwhile, Menshikov could take his time trying out different ways to destroy us. Would he blast us with elemental magic? Change us into bugs? He threw his staff to the ground, and I cursed. Throwing down your staff may sound like a sign of surrender, but in Egyptian magic, it's bad news. It usually means, hey, I'm going to summon a big nasty thing to kill you while I stand safely inside my circle and laugh. Sure enough, Menshikov's staff began to writhe and grow. Great, I thought, another serpent. But something was wrong with this one. Instead of a tail, it had a head on both ends. At first I thought we'd caught some luck, and Menshikov had summoned a monster with a rare genetic birth defect. Then the thing sprouted four dragon legs. Its body grew until it was the size of a draft horse, curved like a U, with mottled red and green scales and a rattlesnake head on either side. It reminded me of that two-headed animal from Dr. Doolittle. You know, the push-me-pull-you? Except Dr. Doolittle would never have wanted to talk to this thing, and if he had, it would probably have just said, "Hello, I'm going to eat you." Both heads turned toward us and hissed. "I've really had enough snakes for 1 week," I muttered. Menshikov smiled.
"Ah, but serpents are my specialty, Carter Kane."
He touched a silver pendant hanging over his necktie, an amulet shaped like a snake.
"And this particular creature is my favorite, the Chesu Hiru. Two hungry mouths to feed, two troublesome children. Perfect."
Sadie and I looked at each other. We had one of those moments where we could read each other's expressions perfectly. We both knew we couldn't defeat Menshikov. He'd let the push-me-pull-you snake wear us down, and if we survived that, he'd just blast us with something else. The guy was a pro. We would either die or get captured, and Bess had warned us about not getting taken alive. After seeing what had happened to that demon Death to Corks, I took Bess's warning seriously. To survive, we'd have to do something crazy, something so suicidal Menshikov would never expect it. We had to get help immediately. "Should I?" Sadie asked. "Do it," I agreed. The Chesu Hiru bared its dripping fangs. You wouldn't think a creature with no back end could move so fast, but it bent both heads toward us like a giant horseshoe and charged. I pulled my sword. Sadie was faster. She pointed her staff at Set's malachite jar and yelled her favorite command word.
"Hadi!"
I was afraid it wouldn't work. She hadn't tried the destruction spell since she separated herself from Isis. But just before the monster reached me, the green jar shattered. Menshikov screamed,
"Nyet!"
A sandstorm exploded through the room. Hot winds pushed Sadie and me against the fireplace. A wall of red sand slammed into the Chesu Hiru and sent it flying sideways into a malachite column. Vlad Menshikov was blasted right out of his protective circle and banged his head on a table. He crumpled to the ground, red sand swirling over him until he was completely buried. When the storm cleared, a man in a red silk suit stood in front of us. He had skin the color of cherry Kool-Aid, a shaved head, a dark goatee, and glittering black eyes lined with coal. He looked like an Egyptian devil ready for a night on the town. He grinned and spread his hands in a ta-da gesture.
"That's better. Thank you, Sadie Kane."
To our left, the Chesu Hiru hissed and flailed, trying to get back on its feet. The pile of red sand covering Vlad Menshikov started to move.
"Do something, evil day," Sadie commanded. "Get rid of them."
Set winced.
"No need to get personal with the names."
"Maybe you'd prefer Rockin' Red Reaper?" I asked. Set made a picture frame with his fingers, as if imagining that name on his driver's license.
Yes, that is nice, isn't it?
The Chesuhiru staggered to its feet. It shook both heads and glared at us, but it seemed to ignore Set, even though he was the one who'd slammed it against the wall.
It has beautiful coloration, doesn't it?
Set asked.
A gorgeous specimen.
Just kill it, I yelled. Set looked shocked.
Oh, I couldn't do that. I'm much too fond of snakes. Besides, Getum would have my hide.
Getum? I asked.
Gods for the ethical treatment of monsters.
You're making that up, I yelled. Set grinned.
Still, I'm afraid you'll have to deal with the Chesuhiru on your own.
The monster hissed at us, which probably meant, sweet! I raised my sword to keep it at bay. The pile of red sand shifted. Menshikov's dazed face rose from the top. Set snapped his fingers and a large ceramic pot appeared in the air, shattering on the magician's head. Menshikov slipped back into the sand.
I'll stay here and entertain Vladimir, Set said.
Can't you execrate him or something? Sadie demanded.
Oh, I wish. Unfortunately, I'm rather limited when someone holds my secret name, especially when they've given me specific orders not to kill them.
He stared accusingly at Sadie.
At any rate, I may be able to buy you a few minutes, but Vlad is going to be quite mad when he comes around, so I'd hurry if I were you. Good luck surviving, and good luck eating them, Chesuhiru.
I wanted to strangle Set, but we had bigger problems. As if encouraged by Set's pep talk, the Chesuhiru lunged at us. Sadie and I sprinted for the nearest door. We ran through the Winter Palace with Set's laughter echoing behind us.
11. Carter does something incredibly stupid, and no one is surprised.
I understand, Carter, I do. Have me narrate the most painful part. Of course, I can't blame you. What happened was awful enough for me, but for you, well, I wouldn't want to talk about it either. There we were in the Winter Palace racing down polished marble hallways that were not designed for running. Behind us, the two-headed Chesuhiru skidded and slammed into walls as it tried to turn corners, much like Muffin used to do whenever Gran mopped the floor. That's the only reason the monster didn't catch us immediately. Since we'd teleported into the Malachite room, I had no idea where the nearest exit was. I wasn't even sure if we were actually in the Winter Palace, or if Menshikov's office was some clever facsimile that existed only in the Duat. I was beginning to think we'd never get out, when we rounded a corner, scrambled down a staircase, and spotted a set of glass and iron doors leading out to Palace Square. The Chesuhiru was right behind us. It slipped and rolled down the staircase, demolishing a plaster statue of some unfortunate Tsar. We were 10 meters from the exit when I saw the chains across the doors. Carter! I gasped, waving helplessly at the padlock. I hate to admit just how weak I felt. I didn't have the strength for another spell. Cracking Set's vase in the Malachite room had been my last hurrah, which is a good example of why you shouldn't use magic to solve all your problems. Summoning a divine word to break the vase had taken so much energy, I felt as if I'd been digging holes in the hot sun. It would have been much easier just to throw a rock. If I lived through the night, I decided to add some rocks to my tool bag. We were 3 meters away when Carter thrust his fist toward the doors. The Eye of Horus burned against the padlock and the doors burst open as if they'd been hit by a giant fist. I hadn't seen Carter do anything like that since our fight at the Red Pyramid, but I didn't have time to be amazed. We bolted outside into the wintry night, the Chesuhiru roaring behind us. You'll think I was mad, but my first thought was, that was too easy. Despite the monster chasing us and the business with Set, whom I would strangle at the first opportunity, that backstabbing git. I couldn't help feeling we'd breached Menshikov's inner sanctum and snatched the scroll without nearly enough trouble. Where were the traps, the alarms, the exploding donkey curses? I was certain we'd stolen the authentic scroll. I'd felt the same tingle in my fingers as when I'd taken the one from the Brooklyn Museum. Without the fire, thankfully. So why hadn't the scroll been better protected? I was so tired, I fell a few steps behind Carter, which probably saved my life. I felt a crawling sensation across my scalp. I sensed darkness above me, a feeling that reminded me too much of the shadow of Nekbet's wings. I looked up and saw the Chesuhiru sailing over our heads like a massive bullfrog, timing its pounce so it would land. "Carter, stop!" I yelled. Easier said than done on icy pavement. I skidded to a halt, but Carter was going too fast. He fell on his bum and slid, his sword skittering to one side. The Chesuhiru landed right on top of him. If it hadn't been U-shaped, Carter would have been crushed, but it curved around him like an enormous pair of headphones, one head glaring down at him from either side. How could something so large have leapt so far? Too late, I realized we should have stayed inside where it was harder for the monster to move. Out here, we had no chance of outrunning it. Carter, I said, stay perfectly still. He froze in crab walk position. The monster's two heads dripped venom that hissed and steamed on the icy stones. Oi! I yelled. Not having any rocks, I picked up a chunk of broken ice and threw it at the Chesuhiru. Naturally, I hit Carter in the back instead. Nevertheless, I got the Chesuhiru's attention. Both heads turned toward me, twin tongues flickering. First step done, distract the monster. Second step, find some clever way to draw it away from Carter. That part was giving me a bit more trouble. I'd used my only potion. Most of my magic supplies were gone. My staff and wand wouldn't do me much good with my magical reserves drained. The knife from Anubis. Somehow I doubted this was the right situation to open someone's mouth. The amulet from Walt. I had not the slightest idea how to use it. For the millionth time, I regretted having given up the spirit of Isis. I could really have used the full magic arsenal of a goddess. But, of course, that was exactly why I'd had to separate from her. That sort of power is intoxicating, dangerously addictive. It can quickly destroy your life. But what if I could form a limited bond? In the Malachite room, I'd managed the Hardy spell for the first time in months. And while it had been difficult, it hadn't been impossible. Right, Isis, I thought, here's what I need.
Don't think, Sadie,
her voice whispered back almost immediately, which was quite a shock.
Divine magic has to be involuntary, like breathing.
You mean, I stopped myself, don't think. Well, that shouldn't be too hard. I held up my staff and a golden hieroglyph blazed in the air. A 1 meter tall taite lit up the courtyard like a Christmas tree star. The Chesuhiru snarled, its yellow eyes fixed on the hieroglyph. Don't like that, eh? I called. Symbol of Isis, you big ugly mutt! Now get away from my brother! It was a complete bluff, of course. I doubted the glowing sign could do anything useful, but I hoped the snake creature wasn't smart enough to know that. Slowly, Carter edged backward. He looked for his sword, but it was 10 meters away, much too far to reach. I kept my eyes on the monster. I used the butt of my staff to trace a magic circle in the snow around me. It wouldn't provide much protection, but it was better than nothing. Carter, I called, when I say go, run back here. That thing's too fast, he said. I'll try to detonate the hieroglyph and blind it. I still maintain that the plan would have worked, but I didn't get the chance to try it. Somewhere off to my left, boots crunched on ice. The monster turned toward the sound. A young man ran into the light of the hieroglyph. He was dressed in a heavy wool coat and a policeman's hat, with a rifle in his hands, but he couldn't have been much older than me. He was fairly drowning in his uniform. When he saw the monster, his eyes widened. He stumbled backward, almost dropping his weapon. He yelled something at me in Russian, probably, "Why is there a two-headed snake monster with no bum?" The monster hissed at both of us, which it could do, having two heads. "That's a monster," I told the guard. I was fairly sure he couldn't understand, but I tried to keep my tone steady. Stay calm and don't shoot. I'm trying to save my brother. The guard swallowed. His large ears were the only things holding up his hat. He glanced from the monster to Carter to the Taiit glowing above my head. Then he did something I wasn't expecting. He said a word in ancient Egyptian, Hekat, the command I always used to summon my staff. His rifle changed to a 2-meter oaken rod with the carved head of a falcon. Wonderful, I thought. The security guards are secretly magicians. He addressed me in Russian, some sort of warning. I recognized the name Menshikov. Let me guess, I said. You want to take me to your leader? The Jesuhiru snapped its jaws. It was rapidly losing its fear of my glowing Taiit. Carter wasn't far enough away to make a run for it. Look, I told the guard, your boss Menshikov is a traitor. He summoned this thing to kill us so we wouldn't blab about his plans to free Apophis. Savvy the word Apophis? Bad snake. Very bad snake. Now, either help me kill this monster or stay out of my way. The magician guard hesitated. He pointed at me nervously. Cain. It wasn't a question. Yes, I agreed. Cain. His expression was a jumble of emotions. Fear, disbelief, possibly even awe. I didn't know what he'd heard about us, but before he could decide whether to help us or fight us, the situation spun out of control. The Jesuhiru charged. My ridiculous brother, instead of rolling out of the way, tackled the monster. He locked his arms around the creature's right neck and tried to climb its back, but the Jesuhiru simply turned its other head to strike. What was my brother thinking? Perhaps he thought he could ride the beast. Perhaps he was trying to buy me a few seconds to cast a spell. If you ask him about it now, he'll claim he doesn't remember the incident at all. But if you ask me, the thick-headed fool was trying to save me, even if it meant sacrificing himself. The nerve! Oh, yes, now you try to explain yourself, Carter. I thought you didn't remember this bit. Just be quiet and let me tell the story. As I was saying, the Jesuhiro struck at Carter and everything seemed to slow down. I remember screaming, lowering my staff at the monster. The soldier magician yelled something in Russian. The creature sank its fangs into Carter's left shoulder and he dropped to the ground. I forgot about my makeshift circle. I ran toward him and my staff glowed. I don't know how I managed the power. As Isis said, I didn't think. I simply channeled all my rage and shock into my staff. Seeing Carter hurt was the final insult. My grandparents had been possessed, my friends had been attacked, and my birthday ruined. But my brother was off limits. No one was allowed to hurt my brother. I unleashed a beam of golden light that hit the monster with the force of a sandblaster. The Jesuhiru crumpled to bits until there was nothing left but a streak of sand steaming in the snow and a few splinters of Menshikov's shattered staff. I ran to Carter's side. He was shivering. His eyes rolled back in his head. 2 puncture wounds in his coat were smoking. Cain, the young Russian said with a tone of awe. I snatched up a splinter of wood and held it for him to see. Your boss Menshikov did this. He's working for Apophis. Menshikov, Apophis. Now get out! The magician may not have understood my words, but he got the message. He turned and ran. I cradled Carter's head. I couldn't carry him by myself, but I had to get him out of here. We were in enemy territory. I needed to find Bess. I struggled to get him to his feet. Then someone took Carter's other arm and helped us up. I found Set grinning at me, still in his ridiculous red disco suit, dusted with malachite rubble. Menshikov's broken white sunglasses were propped on his head. You, I said, too filled with loathing to issue a proper death threat. Me, Set agreed cheerily. Let's get your brother out of here, shall we? Vladimir is not in a good mood. The Nevsky Prospect would have been a lovely place to shop if it hadn't been the wee hours of the morning during a snowstorm and if I hadn't been carrying my poisoned comatose brother. The street had wide pavements, perfect for strolling, lined with a dazzling assortment of high-end boutiques, cafes, churches, and mansions. With all the signs in Russian, I didn't see how I was going to find the chocolate shop. I couldn't spot Bess's black Mercedes anywhere. Set volunteered to carry Carter, but I wasn't about to let the god of chaos take full charge of my brother, so we dragged him between us. Set chatted amiably about the Jesuhiru poison.
Completely incurable, fatal in about 12 hours. It's amazing stuff.
And his tussle with Menshikov.
6 vases broken over his head, and he still survives. I envy his thick skull.
And my prospects of living long enough to find Bess.
Oh, you're toast, my dear. 12 senior magicians were rallying to Menshikov when I made my strategic retreat. They'll be after you shortly. I could have destroyed them all, of course, but I couldn't risk Vladimir using my secret name again. Maybe he'll get amnesia and forget it. Then, if you die, that would be both problems solved. Oh, I'm sorry, I suppose that sounded insensitive. Come along.
Carter's head lolled. His breathing sounded almost as bad as Vlad the Inhaler's. Now, please, don't think I was dense. Of course I remembered the wax mini Carter figurine Jazz had given me. I recognised that this was just the sort of emergency where it might come in handy. How Jazz had predicted Carter would need healing, I had no idea. But it was possible the figurine could draw the poison out of him, despite what Set said about it being incurable. What does a god of evil know about healing, anyway? There were problems, however. First, I knew very little about healing magic. I needed time to figure out the proper casting, and since I had only one wax statue, I couldn't afford to get it wrong. Second, I couldn't very well do that while being chased by Menshikov and his squad of magical Russian goons, nor did I want to let my guard down with Set anywhere near me. I didn't know why he'd decided to be helpful all of a sudden, but the sooner I could lose him, the better. I needed to find Bess and retreat to somewhere safe, if there was such a place. Set kept chatting about all the exciting ways the magicians might kill me once they caught up. Finally, I spotted a bridge up ahead over a frozen canal. Parked in the middle was the black Mercedes. Bess leaned against the hood, eating pieces off a chocolate chessboard. Next to him sat a large plastic bag, hopefully with more chocolate for me. I yelled to him, but he was so engrossed in eating chocolate, which I suppose I could understand, that he didn't notice us until we were a few meters away. Then he looked up and saw Set. I started to say, "Bess, don't..." Too late. Like a skunk, the dwarf god activated his default defense. His eyes bulged out, his mouth opened impossibly wide. He yelled, "Boo!" so loudly my hair parted and icicles rained down from the bridge's street lamps. Set didn't look the least bit fazed.
"Hello, Bess," he said. "Really, you're not so scary with chocolate smeared on your face."
Bess glared at me.
"What's he doing here?"
"Not my idea," I promised. I gave him the abbreviated story of our encounter with Menshikov. "And so Carter's been hurt," I summed up, which seemed rather obvious. "We have to get him out of here."
"But first,"
Set interrupted, pointing at the chocolate museum bag next to Bess.
"I can't stand surprises. What's in there? A gift for me?"
Bess frowned.
"Sadie wanted a souvenir. I brought her Lenin's head."
Set slapped his thigh with delight.
"Bess, how evil. There's hope for you yet."
"Not his real head," Bess said. "It's chocolate."
"Oh, shame. Can I have part of your chessboard, then? I simply love eating pawns."
"Get out of here, Set," Bess said.
"Well, I could do that, but since our friends are on their way, I thought perhaps we should make a deal."
Set snapped his fingers and a globe of red light appeared in front of him. In it, the holographic images of 6 men in security uniforms piled into 2 white sports cars. Their headlights blazed to life. The cars swerved across a parking lot, then passed straight through a stone wall as if it were made of smoke.
"I'd say you have about 2 minutes."
Set smiled, and the globe of light faded.
You remember Menshikov's minions, Bess? Are you sure you want to meet them again?
The dwarf god's face darkened. He crushed a white chocolate chess piece in his hand.
You lying, scheming, murdering...
Stop, I said. Carter groaned in his poisoned daze. Either he was getting heavier or I was getting tired of holding him up. We don't have time to argue, I said. Set, are you offering to stop the magicians? He laughed.
No, no. I'm still hoping they'll kill you, you see. But I was going to offer you the location of the last scroll in the Book of Ra. That is what you're after, isn't it?
I assumed he was lying. He usually was. But if he was serious... I looked at Bess. Is it possible he knows the location? Bess grunted.
More than possible. The priests of Ra gave him the scroll for safekeeping.
Why on earth would they do that? Set tried to look modest.
Come now, Sadie. I was a loyal lieutenant of Ra. If you were Ra and you didn't want to be bothered by any old magician trying to wake you, wouldn't you trust the key to your location with your most fearsome servant?
He had a point. Where's the scroll, then?
Not so fast. I'll give you the location if you give me back my secret name.
Not likely!
It's quite simple. Just say, I give you back your name. You'll forget the proper way to say it.
And then I'll have no power over you. You'll kill me!
You'd have my word that I won't.
Right, that's worth a lot. What if I used your secret name to force you to tell me? Set shrugged.
With a few days to research the correct spell, you might manage that. Unfortunately...
He cupped his ear to his hand. In the distance, tires squealed. Two cars, travelling fast, getting closer.
You don't have a few days.
Bess cursed an Egyptian.
Don't do it, girl. He can't be trusted.
Can we find the scroll without him?
Well, maybe. Probably not. No.
The headlights of two cars swerved onto the Nevsky Prospect, roughly half a mile away. We were out of time. I had to get Carter away from here, but if Set really was our only way of finding the scroll, I couldn't just let him go. All right, Set, but I'll give you one last order. Bess sighed.
I can't bear to watch this. Give me your brother. I'll put him in the car.
The dwarf took Carter and stuffed him into the back seat of the Mercedes. I kept my eyes on Set, trying to think of the least terrible way to make this deal. I couldn't simply tell him to never hurt my family. A magical pact needed to be carefully worded with clear limits and an expiration date, or the whole spell would unravel. Evil Day, you are not to harm the Kane family. You'll maintain a truce with us at least until... until Ra has been awakened.
Or until you try and fail to awaken him?
Set asked innocently. If that happens, I said, the world is going to end. So why not? I will do what you ask concerning your name. In exchange, you will tell me the location of the last part of the Book of Ra without trickery or deception. Then you'll depart for the Duat. Set considered the offer. The two white sports cars were only a few blocks away now. Bess shut Carter's door and ran back over.
We have a deal, Set agreed. You'll find the scroll at Baharia. Bess knows the place, I mean.
Bess didn't look happy.
That place is heavily protected. We'll have to use the Alexandria portal. Yes,
Set grinned.
Should be interesting. How long can you hold your breath, Sadie Kane?
What do you mean?
Never mind, never mind. Now, I believe you owe me a secret name.
I give you back your name, I said. Just like that, I felt the magic leave me. I still knew Set's name, Evil Day. But somehow I couldn't remember exactly how I used to say it or how it worked in a spell. The memory had been erased. To my surprise, Set didn't kill me on the spot. He just smiled and tossed me Vlad Menshikov's sunglasses.
I hope you live after all, Sadie Kane. You're quite amusing. But if they do kill you, at least enjoy the experience. Gosh, thanks. And just because I like you so much, I have a free piece of information for your brother. Tell him Zia Rashid's village was called Al-Hamra Makan. Why is that? Happy travels.
Set disappeared in a cloud of blood-coloured mist. A block away, the two white sports cars barreled toward us. A magician stuck his head out of the sunroof of the lead car and pointed his staff in our direction.
Time to leave, Bess said. Get in.
I will say this for Bess. He drove like a maniac, and I mean that in the best possible way. Icy streets didn't bother him at all. Neither did traffic signals, pedestrian pavements, or canals, which he twice jumped without bothering to find a bridge. Fortunately, the city was mostly empty that time of morning, or I'm sure we would have mowed down any number of Russians. We wove through central St. Petersburg while the two white sports cars closed behind us. I tried to hold Carter steady next to me in the back seat. His eyes were half open, his corneas the most awful shade of green. Despite the cold, he was burning with fever. I managed to tug off his winter coat and found his shirt soaked with sweat. On his shoulder, the puncture wounds were oozing like... Well, it's probably best I don't describe that part... I glanced behind us. The magician in the sunroof aimed his staff, not an easy task in a high-speed car chase, and a glowing white javelin shot from the tip, hurtling toward us like a homing missile. Duck! I yelled and pushed Carter against the seat. The javelin broke the rear window and flew straight through the windshield. If Bess had been normal height, he would have gotten a free head piercing. As it was, the projectile missed him completely.
I'm a dwarf, he grumbled. I don't duck.
He swerved to the right. Behind us, a storefront exploded. Looking back, I saw the entire wall dissolve into a pile of living snakes. Our pursuers were still closing. Bess, get us out of here, I yelled.
I'm trying, kid. Egyptian bridge is coming up. It was originally built in the 1800s, but
I don't care, just drive. Truly, it's amazing how many Egyptian bits and bobs there are in St. Petersburg and how little I cared about them. Being chased by evil magicians throwing javelins and snake bombs does tend to clarify one's priorities. Suffice it to say, yes, there really is an Egyptian bridge over the Fontanka River leading south out of central St. Petersburg. Why? No idea. Don't care. As we raced toward it, I saw black stone sphinxes on either side, ladies' sphinxes with gilded pharaoh crowns, but the only thing that mattered to me was that they could summon a portal. Bess barked something in Egyptian. At the top of the bridge, blue light flashed. A swirling sand vortex appeared. What did Set mean, I asked, about holding my breath?
Hopefully it won't be for long, Bess said. We'll only be 30 feet under.
30 feet underwater?!
Bang!
The Mercedes careened sideways. Only later did I realize another javelin must have hit our back tire. We spun across the ice and flipped, sliding upside down into the vortex. My head slammed against something. I opened my eyes, fighting for consciousness, but either I was blind or we were in complete darkness. I heard water trickling through the javelin-shattered glass and the roof of the Mercedes crumpling like an aluminum can. I had time to think, a teenager for less than a day and I'm going to drown. Then I blacked out. 12. I master the fine art of name-calling. It's disturbing to wake up as a chicken. My bar floated through dark water. My glowing wings flapped as I tried to figure out which way was up. I assumed my body was somewhere close by, possibly already drowned in the back of the Mercedes, but I couldn't figure out how to return to it. Why on earth had Bess driven us through an underwater portal? I hoped poor Carter had somehow survived. Perhaps Bess was able to pull him free, but dying from poison rather than drowning didn't seem much of an improvement. A current caught me and whisked me into the Duat. The water changed into cold fog. Wailing and growling filled the darkness. My acceleration slowed, and when the mist dissipated, I was back in Brooklyn House, floating just outside the infirmary door.
on a bench against the wall, sitting together like old friends, were Anubis and Walt Stone. They looked like they were waiting for bad news. Walt's hands were folded in his lap, his shoulders slumped. He'd changed clothes, a new sleeveless tee, a new pair of running shorts, but he looked like he hadn't slept since returning from London. Anubis talked to him in soothing tones, as if trying to ease his grief. I'd never seen Anubis in traditional Egyptian clothes before. Bare-chested, with a golden ruby collar around his neck, a simple black kilt wrapped around his waist. It wasn't a look I'd recommend for most guys, but Anubis pulled it off. I'd always imagined he would look rather skinny with his shirt off. Not that I'd imagined that a lot, mind you, but he was in excellent shape. They must have had quite a good gym in the underworld, bench-pressing tombstones and whatnot. At any rate, after the shock of seeing them together, my first thought was that something terrible must have happened to Jazz. "What is it?" I asked, not sure if they could hear me. "What's happened?" Walt didn't react, but Anubis looked up. As usual, my heart did a little happy dance without my permission. His eyes were so mesmerizing I completely forgot how to use my brain. I said, I know Liz would have been proud.
Sadie, Anubis said, you shouldn't be here. Carter is dying.
That jarred me back to my senses. I know that, jackal boy. I didn't ask to be... Wait, why am I here? Anubis pointed at the door of the infirmary.
I suspect Jazz's spirit called to you.
Is she dead? Am I dead?
Neither, Anubis said. But you are both on death's doorstep, which means your souls can speak to each other quite easily. Just don't stay long.
Walt still hadn't acknowledged me. He muttered,
Couldn't tell her. Why couldn't I tell her?
He opened his hands. Cradled in his palms was a golden Shen amulet, exactly like the one he'd given me. Anubis, what's wrong with him? I asked. Can't he hear me?
Anubis put his hand on Walt's shoulder. He can't see either of us, though I think he can sense my presence. He called to me for guidance. That's why I'm here.
Guidance from you? Why? I suppose it sounded harsher than I intended, but of all the gods Walt might have called, Anubis seemed the least likely choice. Anubis looks up at me, his eyes even more melancholy than usual.
You should pass on now, Sadie, he said. You have very little time. I promise I'll do my best to ease Walt's pain.
His pain? I asked. Hang on! But the infirmary door swung open and the currents of the Duat pulled me inside. The infirmary was the nicest medical facility I'd ever been in, but that wasn't saying much. I hated hospitals. My father used to joke that I was born screaming and didn't stop until they got me out of the maternity ward. I was mortally afraid of needles, pills, and above all, the smell of sick people. Dead people and cemeteries, those didn't bother me. But sickness? Well, I'm sorry, but does it have to smell so bloody sick? My first visit to Jazz in the infirmary had taken all my courage. This second time, even in bar form, wasn't any easier. The room was about the size of my bedroom. The walls were rough-hewn limestone. Large windows let in the nighttime glow of New York. Cedar cabinets were carefully labelled with medicines, first aid supplies, magical charms and potions. In one corner stood a fountain with a life-size statue of the lion goddess Sekhmet, patron of healers. I'd heard that the water pouring through Sekhmet's hands could cure a cold or flu instantly and provide most of one's daily vitamins and iron, but I'd never had the courage to take a drink. The gurgle of the fountain was peaceful enough. Instead of antiseptic, the air smelled of charmed vanilla-scented candles that floated around the room. But still, the place made me jumpy. I knew the candles monitored the patient's conditions. Their flames changed colour to indicate problems. At the moment, they all hovered around the only occupied bed, Jazz's. Their flames were dark orange. Jazz's hands were folded on her chest. Her blonde hair was combed across her pillow.
She smiled faintly, as if she were having a pleasant dream. And sitting at the foot of Jazz's bed was Jazz, or at least a shimmering green image of my friend. It wasn't a bar. The form was fully human. I wondered if she'd died after all, and this was her ghost. Jazz! A wave of fresh guilt washed over me. Everything that had gone wrong the past 2 days had started with Jazzy's sacrifice, which was my fault. Are you dead? No, Sadie. This is my Ran. Her transparent body flickered. When I looked more closely, I saw it was composed of images, like a 3D video of Jazzy's life. Toddler Jazz sat in a high chair, painting her face with baby food. 12-year-old Jazz cartwheeled across a gymnasium floor, trying out for her first cheerleading squad. Present-day Jazz opened her school locker and found a glowing Jed amulet, our magical calling card that had led her to Brooklyn. "You're Ren?" I said. "Another part of your soul?" The glowing green image nodded. "Egyptians believed there were 5 different parts of the soul. The Ba is the personality. The Ren is your name," I remembered. "But how can that be your name?" "My name is my identity," she said. "The sum of my experiences. As long as my name is remembered, I still exist, even if I die. Do you understand?" I didn't, even remotely, but I understood she might die and that it was my fault. "I'm so sorry," I tried not to break into tears. "If I hadn't grabbed that stupid scroll..."
"Sadie, don't be sorry. I'm glad you've come."
"But..."
"Everything happens for a reason, Sadie. Even bad things."
"That's not true," I said. "It's bloody unfair. How could Jazz be so calm and nice, even when she was in a coma? I didn't want to hear that bad things happened as part of some grand plan. I hated when people said that. I'd lost my mother, I'd lost my dad, my life had been turned upside down, and I'd almost died countless times. Now, as far as I knew, I was dead or dying. My brother was poisoned and drowning, and I couldn't help him." "No reason is worth all this," I said. "Life is random, it's harsh, it's... it's..." Jazz was still smiling, looking a bit amused. "Oh," I said, "you wanted to make me mad, didn't you?"
"That's the Sadie we all love. Grief really isn't productive. You do better when you're angry."
I supposed she was right, but I didn't have to like it. "So why did you bring me here?"
"Two things,"
she said.
"First, you're not dead. When you wake up, you'll only have a few minutes to heal Carter. You'll have to act quickly."
"Using the wax statue," I said. "Yes, I figured that out. But I don't know how. I'm no good at healing."
"There's only one more ingredient that matters. You know what it is."
"But I don't." Jazz raised an eyebrow like I was just being stubborn.
"You're so close to understanding, Sadie. Think about Isis. Think about how you channeled her power in St. Petersburg. The answer will come to you."
"But..."
"We must hurry. The second thing, you're going to need Walt's help. I know it's risky. I know Bess warned against it, but use the amulet to call Walt back to you. It's what he wants. Some risks are worth taking, even if it means losing a life."
"Losing whose life? His?" The infirmary scene began to dissolve, turning into a blurry watercolor.
"Think about Isis,"
Jazz repeated.
"And Sadie, there is a purpose. You taught us that. We choose to believe in Mott. We create order out of chaos, beauty and meaning out of ugly randomness. That's what Egypt is all about. That's why its name, its Ren, has endured for millennia. Don't despair. Otherwise, chaos wins."
I remembered saying something like that in one of our classes, but even then I hadn't believed it. "I'll let you in on a secret," I said. "I'm a rubbish teacher." Jazzy's form, all her collected memories, slowly melted into mist.
I'll let you in on a secret, she said, her voice fading. You were an excellent teacher. Now visit Isis and see how it began. The infirmary evaporated. Suddenly, I was on a royal barge floating down the Nile. The sun blazed overhead. Lush green marsh grass and palm trees lined the riverbanks. Beyond that, the desert spread to the horizon, barren red hills so dry and forbidding they might as well have been on Mars. The boat was like the one Carter had described from his vision with Horus, though in better condition. Its crisp white sail was emblazoned with the image of the sun disk, glittering in red and gold. Orbs of multicolored light zipped around the deck, manning the oars and pulling the lines. How they did this without hands, I don't know, but it wasn't the first time I'd seen such a magical crew. The hull was inlaid with precious metals, copper, silver and gold designs, showing pictures of the boat's journey through the Duat and hieroglyphs invoking the power of the sun. In the middle of the boat, a blue and gold canopy shaded the sun god's throne, which was without a doubt the most impressive and uncomfortable-looking chair I'd ever seen. At first, I thought it was molten gold. Then I realized it was fashioned out of living fire, yellow flames that had somehow been sculpted into the shape of a throne. Etched into its legs and armrests, white-hot hieroglyphs glowed so brightly they seared my eyes. The throne's occupant wasn't quite so impressive. Ra was an old leathery man bent over in the shape of a question mark, his bald scalp cratered with liver spots, and his face so saggy and wrinkled it looked like a mask. Only his coal-lined eyes gave any indication he was alive, because they were full of pain and weariness. He wore a kilt and collar, which did not suit him nearly as well as it had Anubis. Until now, the most ancient person I'd ever seen was Iskander, the former chief lector, who'd been 2,000 years old. But Iskander had never looked this bad, even when he was about to die. To make matters worse, Ra's left leg was wrapped in bandages and swollen to twice its proper size. He groaned and propped his leg on a pile of cushions. Two puncture wounds oozed through the bandages on his shin, very much like the fang marks on Carter's shoulder. As Ra kneaded his leg, green venom spread up the veins of his thigh. Just looking at it made my bar feathers shiver with revulsion. Ra looked to the heavens. His eyes turned molten yellow, like his throne.
"Isis," he cried. "Very well, I relent."
A shadow rippled under the canopy. A woman appeared and knelt before the throne. I recognized her, of course. She had long, dark hair cut Cleopatra style and a white gossamer dress that complemented her graceful figure. Her luminous rainbow wings shimmered like the northern lights. With her head bowed and her palms raised in supplication, she looked like the picture of humility. But I knew Isis too well. I could see the smile she was trying to hide. I could sense her elation. "Lord Ra," she said, "I live to serve you."
"Ha!" Ra said. "You live for power, Isis. Don't try to deceive me. I know you created the snake that bit me. That's why no one else can find a cure. You desire my throne for your husband, the upstart Osiris."
Isis started to protest. "My lord,
enough! If I were a younger god..."
Ra made the mistake of moving his leg. He yelped in pain. The green venom spread farther up his veins.
"Never mind," he sighed miserably. "I am weary of this world. Enough scheming and plotting. Just cure the poison."
"Gladly, my king. But I will need..."
"My secret name," Ra said. "Yes, I know. Promise to heal me, and you will get all you desire. And more.
I heard the warning in Ra's voice, but either Isis didn't notice or she didn't care. I swear to heal you, she said.
Then approach, goddess.
Isis leaned forward. I thought Ra would whisper his name in her ear, but instead he grasped her hand and placed it against his withered brow. Her fingertips smoldered. She tried to pull away, but Ra held her wrist. The sun god's entire form glowed with fiery images of his long life. The first dawn, his sunboat shining on the newly risen land of Egypt, the creation of the other gods and mortal men, Ra's endless battles with Apophis as he passed through the Duat each night, keeping chaos at bay. It was too much to take in, centuries passing with each heartbeat. His secret name was the sum of his experience, and even then, in those ancient times, Ra was unthinkably old. The fiery aura spread to Isis's hand, travelling up her arm until her whole body was wreathed in flames. She screamed once, then the fires died. Isis collapsed, smoke curling from her dress.
So, Ra said, you survived.
I couldn't tell if he felt disappointment or grudging respect. Isis rose unsteadily to her feet. She looked shell-shocked, as if she'd just strolled through a war zone, but she raised her hand. A fiery hieroglyph burned on her palm, Ra's secret name distilled into a single, unbelievably powerful word. She placed her hand on Ra's poisoned leg and spoke a spell. The green venom retreated from his veins. The swelling subsided, the bandages fell away, and the two fang marks closed. Ra reclined on his throne and sighed with relief.
At last, no pain.
My lord needs rest, Isis suggested. A long, long rest. The sun god opened his eyes. There was no fire in them now. They looked like the milky eyes of a mortal old man.
Bast, he called.
The cat goddess materialized at his side. She was dressed in Egyptian armor of leather and iron, and she seemed younger, though perhaps that was just because she hadn't yet endured centuries in a prison abyss fighting Apophis. I was tempted to shout to her and warn her about what was coming, but my voice wouldn't work.
Bast gave Isis a sideways look. My lord, is this woman bothering you?
Ra shook his head.
Nothing will bother me much longer, my faithful cat. Come with me now. We have important matters to discuss before I depart. My lord, where are you going? Into forced retirement.
Ra glared at Isis.
That is what you want, goddess of magic.
Isis bowed.
Never, my lord.
Bast drew her knives and stepped toward Isis, but Ra held out his arm.
Enough, Bast, he said. I have another fight in mind for you. One last crucial fight. As for you, Isis, you may think you have won because you mastered my secret name. Do you realize what you've started? Osiris may become pharaoh, but his reign will be short and bitter. His royal seat will be a pale reflection of my throne of fire. This boat will no longer ride the Duat. The balance between Maat and Chaos will slowly degrade. Egypt itself will fall. The names of her gods will fade to a distant memory. Then one day the entire world will stand on the brink of destruction. You will cry out to Ra, and I will not be there. When that day comes, remember how your greed and ambition caused it to happen.
My lord. Isis bowed respectfully, but I knew she wasn't thinking about some distant future. She was drunk with her victory. She thought Osiris would rule Egypt forever and that Ra was just an old fool. She did not know that in a short time her victory would turn to tragedy. Osiris would be murdered by his brother Set, and someday Ra's other predictions would come true as well.
"Let us go, Bast," Ra said. "We are no longer wanted."
The throne erupted in a column of flames, burning away the blue and gold canopy. A ball of fire ascended into the heavens until it was lost in the glare of the sun. When the smoke cleared, Isis stood alone and laughed with delight. "I did it," she exclaimed. "Osiris, you will be king. I mastered the secret name of Ra." I wanted to tell her she had mastered nothing, but I could only watch as Isis danced across the boat. She was so pleased with her own success, she paid no attention to the magical servant lights disappearing. The lines dropped, the sail went slack, oars trailed in the water, and the sun boat drifted down the river, unmanned. My vision faded, and I sank into darkness. I woke in a soft bed. For a blissful moment, I thought I was back in my room at Brooklyn House. I could get up and have a lovely breakfast with my friends, Amos, Philip of Macedonia, and Hufu, then spend the day teaching our initiates how to turn each other into reptiles. That sounded brilliant. But of course, I wasn't home. I sat up, and my head began spinning. I was in a king-size bed with soft cotton sheets and a pile of feather pillows. The bedroom was quite posh, decorated in dazzling white, which did not help my dizziness. I felt as if I were back in the home of the sky goddess, Nut. At any moment, the room might dissolve into clouds. My legs felt stiff, but I managed to get out of bed. I was wearing one of those hotel robes, so massive and plush, I looked like an albino muppet. I staggered to the doorway and found a lovely living room, also bright white. Sliding glass doors led to a veranda that overlooked the sea from quite a height, possibly 15 or 20 stories. The sky and the water were gorgeous blue. My eyes took a moment to adjust to the light. On a nearby table, Carter's and my few possessions were carefully laid out, our old rumpled clothes, our magic bags, and the 2 scrolls from the Book of Ra, along with Bess's bag from the Chocolate Museum. Carter was wrapped in a white robe like mine. He lay on the couch with his eyes closed. His whole body shivered. Bess sat next to him, dabbing Carter's forehead with a cool cloth. How is he? I managed. Bess glanced over. He looked like a miniature tourist in a loud Hawaiian shirt, khaki shorts and flip-flops. The ugly American, size extra small.
About time, he said. I was beginning to think you'd never wake up.
I took a step forward, but the room tilted back and forth.
Careful!
Bess rushed over and took my arm.
You got a nasty bump on the head.
Never mind that, I muttered. I have to help Carter.
He's bad, Sadie. I don't know if...
I can help. My wand and the wax figurine.
Yeah, okay, I'll get them.
With Bess's assistance, I wobbled to Carter's side. Bess fetched my things while I checked Carter's forehead. His fever was worse than before. The veins in his neck had turned green from the poison, just like Ra's had in my vision. I frowned at Bess. How long was I out?
It's almost noon on Tuesday.
He spread my magic supplies at Carter's feet.
So, roughly 12 hours.
12 hours?! Bess, that's the maximum time Set thought Carter could stay alive before the poison killed him. Why didn't you wake me sooner?
His face turned as red as his Hawaiian shirt. I tried. I pulled you both out of the Mediterranean and got you to the hotel, didn't I? I used all the wake-up spells I know. You just kept muttering in your sleep about Walt, Anubis, secret names.
Fine, I said. Just help me. The doorbell rang. Bess gestured for me to stay calm. He called out in another language, possibly Arabic, and a hotel waiter opened the door. He bowed low to Bess, as if the dwarf were a sultan, then brought in a room service cart loaded with tropical fruit, fresh-baked breads, and bottled sodas.
Excellent, Bess told me. Be right back.
You're wasting time, I snapped.
Naturally, Bess ignored me. He retrieved his bag from the dining table and brought out the chocolate head of Vladimir Lenin. The waiter's eyes widened. Bess put the head in the middle of the cart and nodded as if it made the perfect centerpiece. Bess gave the waiter a few more orders in Arabic, then handed him some gold coins. The waiter grovelled and generally looked terrified. He exited backward, still bowing. "Where are we exactly?" I asked. "And why are you a king here?"
"Alexandria, Egypt," Bess said. "Sorry about the rough arrival. It's a tricky place to teleport to. Cleopatra's old capital, you know, where the Egyptian Empire fell apart, so magic tends to get twisted around. The only working portals are in the old city, which is off the coast under 30 feet of water."
"And this place? Obviously a luxury hotel, but how did you..."
"Penthouse suite, 4 seasons, Alexandria."
He sounded slightly embarrassed.
"People in Egypt still remember the old gods, even if they won't admit it. I was popular back in the day, so I can usually call in favors when I need them. Sorry I didn't have more time. I could have gotten us a private villa."
"How dare you," I said, "making us settle for a 5-star hotel. Now why don't you make sure we're not interrupted while I heal Carter?" I grabbed the wax figurine Jazz had given me and knelt next to my brother. The statue was deformed from getting knocked around in my bag. Then again, Carter looked worse for wear too. Hopefully the magic connection would still work. "Carter," I said, "I'm going to heal you, but I need your help." I put my hand on his feverish forehead. Now I knew why Jazz had appeared to me as a wren, the part of the soul that represented her name. I knew why she'd shown me the vision of Isis and Ra. "You're so close to understanding, Sadie," she'd said. I'd never thought about it before, but the wren was the same as one's secret name. It was more than just a special word. "The secret name is your darkest thoughts, your most embarrassing moments, your biggest dreams, your worst fears, all wrapped together. It's the sum of your experiences, even those you'd never want to share. Your secret name makes you who you are. That's why a secret name has power. It's also why you couldn't simply hear someone repeat a secret name and know how to use it. You had to know that person and understand their life. The more you understood the person, the more power their name could yield. You could only learn a secret name from the person himself, or from the person closest to his heart. And heaven help me, for me, Carter was that person. Carter, I thought, what is your secret name?" Even in sickness, his mind resisted me. You don't just hand over your secret name. Every human had one, just as each god did. But most humans spent their whole lives not knowing that, not ever putting in words their most private identity. Understandable, really. Try summing up your entire existence in 5 words or less. Not exactly easy, is it? "You can do this," I murmured. "You're my brother. I love you. All the embarrassing bits, all the annoying bits, which I imagine is most of you. 1,000 Zias might run away from you if they knew the truth, but I won't. I'll still be here. Now tell me your name, you big idiot, so I can save your life." My hand tingled against his forehead. His life passed through my fingers. Ghostly memories of when we were children, living with our parents in Los Angeles. I saw my birthday party when I turned 6 and the cake exploded. I saw our mother reading bedtime stories to us from a college science textbook. Our dad playing jazz and dancing me around the room while Carter covered his ears and yelled, "Dad!" I saw moments I hadn't shared with my brother as well. Carter and Dad caught in a riot in Paris. Carter and Zia talking by candlelight in the first gnome. Carter by himself in the library at Brooklyn House, staring at his Eye of Horus amulet and struggling against the temptation to reclaim the power of a god. He'd never told me about that, but it made me feel relieved. I thought I was the only one who'd been so tempted. Slowly, Carter relaxed. His worst fears passed through me, his most embarrassing secrets. His strength was failing as the poison gripped his heart. With his last bit of willpower, he told me his name. Of course, I won't tell you what it is. You couldn't use it anyway, hearing it from a recording, but I won't take chances.
I raised the wax figurine and spoke Carter's secret name. Immediately, the poison receded from his veins. The wax figure turned green and melted in my hands. Carter's fever broke. He shuddered, took a deep breath, and opened his eyes. "Right," I said sternly. "Don't ever ride another bloody snake monster again."
"Sorry," he croaked.
"Did you just..."
"Yeah. With my secret name?"
"Yeah."
"And all my secrets?"
"Yeah." He groaned and covered his face as if he wanted to fall back into a coma, but honestly, I had no intention of teasing him. There's a difference between keeping your brother in his place and being cruel. I wasn't cruel. Besides, after seeing into the darkest recesses of Carter's mind, I was a bit ashamed, possibly even in awe. There really wasn't much there. Compared to my fears and embarrassing secrets, oh dear, he was tame. I hoped our situations were never reversed and he had to heal me. Bess came over with Lenin's head tucked in the crook of his arm. He'd obviously been having a nibble, as Lenin's forehead was missing, victim of a frontal chocolobotomy.
"Good work, Sadie."
He broke off Lenin's nose and offered it to Carter.
"Here, boy, you've earned this."
Carter frowned.
"Does chocolate have magic healing properties?"
Bess snorted.
"If it did, I'd be the healthiest dwarf in the world. Nah, it just tastes good."
"And you'll need your strength," I added. "We have a lot to talk about." Despite our looming deadline, as of tomorrow, only 2 more days until the equinox and the end of the world, Bess insisted we rest until the following morning. He warned that if Carter exerted himself physically or magically any sooner after being poisoned, it might well kill him. Losing the time made me quite agitated, but after going to so much trouble to revive my brother, I rather wanted to keep him alive. And I'll admit, I wasn't in much better shape. I was so drained magically myself, I don't think I could have moved farther than the veranda. Bess called the front desk and ordered a personal shopper to buy us some new clothes and supplies in town. I'm not sure what the Arabic word is for combat boots, but the shopping lady managed to find a new pair. When she delivered our things, she tried to give the boots to Carter, then looked horrified when Bess pointed at me. I also got a supply of hair dye, a comfortable pair of jeans, a cotton top in desert camouflage colours, and a headscarf that was probably all the rage with Egyptian women, but which I decided not to wear, as it would probably clash with the new purple highlights I wanted for my hair. Carter got jeans, boots, and a T-shirt that read Property of Alexandria University in English and Arabic. Clearly, even personal shoppers had him pegged as a complete geek. The shopper also managed to find some supplies for our magic bags. Blocks of wax, twine, even some papyrus and ink, though I doubt Bess explained to her what they were for. After she left, Bess, Carter and I ordered more food from room service. We sat on the deck and watched the afternoon go by. The breeze from the Mediterranean was cool and pleasant. Modern Alexandria stretched out to our left, an odd mix of gleaming high-rises, shabby, crumbling buildings, and ancient ruins. The shoreline highway was dotted with palm trees and crowded with every sort of vehicle, from BMWs to donkeys. From our penthouse suite, it all seemed a bit unreal, the raw energy of the city, the bustle and congestion below, while we sat on our veranda in the sky eating fresh fruit and the last melting bits of Lenin's head. I wondered if this was how the gods felt, watching the mortal world from their throne room in the Duat. As we talked, I set the 2 scrolls from the Book of Ra on the patio table. They looked so plain and harmless, yet we'd almost died retrieving them. Still one more to find, then the real fun would begin, figuring out how to use them to awaken Ra. It seemed impossible we could do so much in 48 hours, yet here we sat, sidelined and exhausted, forced to rest until the morning. Carter and his bloody heroics getting bitten by that Dr. Doolittle snake, and he calls me impulsive. Meanwhile, Amos and our rookie initiates were left alone at Brooklyn House, preparing to defend against Vlad Menshikov, a magician so ruthless he was on a secret name basis with the God of Evil.
I told Carter what had happened in St. Petersburg after he got poisoned, how I'd given up Set's name in exchange for the location of the last scroll, someplace called Baharia. I described my vision of Anubis and Walt, my chat with Jazzy's spirit, and my trip back in time to Ra's sun barge. The only thing I held back? What Set had said about Zia's village being named Al-Hamra Makan. And yes, I know that was wrong, but I'd just been inside Carter's head. I now understood how important Zia was to him. I knew how badly any information about her would rattle him. Carter sat in his lounge chair and listened intently. His colour had returned to normal. His eyes were clear and alert. It was hard to believe he'd been on death's door only hours before. I wanted to credit my healing powers, but I had a feeling his recovery had as much to do with the rest, several ginger ales, and a room-service cheeseburger with chips. Baharia. He looked at Bess. I know that name. Why do I know that name? Bess scratched his beard. He'd been glum and silent since I'd recounted our conversation with Set. The name Baharia seemed especially to bother him.
It's an oasis, he said. Way out in the desert. The mummies buried there were a secret until 1996. Then some fool donkey put its leg through a hole in the ground and broke open the top of a tomb.
Right! Carter beamed at me, that gee, history is cool light in his eyes, so I knew he must be feeling better. It's called the Valley of the Golden Mummies. I like gold, I said. Mummies, not so much.
Oh, you just haven't met enough mummies. Bess said.
I couldn't tell if he was joking, and I decided not to ask. So the last scroll is hidden there? Bess shrugged.
It would make sense. The oasis is out of the way. Wasn't found until recently. There are also powerful curses in place to prevent portal travel. The mortal archaeologists have excavated some of the tunnels, but there's still a huge network of tunnels and chambers no one's opened in thousands of years. Lots of mummies.
I imagined horror film mummies with their arms out and their linen wraps coming undone, groaning as they chased screaming starlets and strangled archaeologists. When you say lots of mummies, I ventured, how many is lots?
They've uncovered a few hundred, Bess said, out of maybe 10,000.
10,000? I looked at Carter, who didn't seem bothered by this at all. Sadie, he said, it's not like they're going to come to life and kill you.
No, Bess agreed, probably not. Almost for sure not.
Thanks, I muttered. I feel much better. Yes, I know what I said earlier about dead people and cemeteries not bothering me, but 10,000 mummies, that was pushing it.
Anyway, Bess said, most of the mummies are from Roman times. They're not even properly Egyptian. Bunch of Latin wannabes trying to get into our afterlife because it's cooler. But some of the older tombs, well, we'll just have to see. With two parts of the Book of Ra, you should be able to track down the third part once you get close enough.
How exactly? I asked. Bess shrugged.
When magic items get broken up, the pieces are like magnets. The closer they get, the more they attract each other.
That didn't necessarily make me feel better. I imagined myself running through a tunnel with flaming scrolls stuck to both hands. Right, I said. So all we have to do is creep through a network of tombs past 10,000 golden mummies who probably, almost for sure, won't come to life and kill us.
Yeah, Bess said. Well, they're not really solid gold. Most of them are just painted with gold, but yeah.
That makes a huge difference.
Then it's decided.
Carter sounded positively thrilled.
We can leave in the morning. How far is it?
A little over 200 miles, Bess said. But the roads are iffy. And portals, well, like I said, the oasis is cursed against them. And even if it wasn't, we're back in the first gnome. It would be wise to use as little magic as possible. If you're discovered in Desjardins' home territory...
He didn't need to finish that sentence. I gazed at the skyline of Alexandria curving along the shore of the glittering Mediterranean. I tried to picture it as it might have been in ancient times, before Cleopatra, Egypt's final pharaoh, chose the wrong side in a Roman civil war and lost her life and her kingdom. This was the city where ancient Egypt had died. It didn't seem a very auspicious place to start a quest. Unfortunately, I had no choice. I'd have to travel 200 miles through the desert to some isolated oasis and find one needle of a scroll in a haystack of mummies. I didn't see how we could accomplish this in the time we had left. Worse, I hadn't yet told Carter my last bit of information about Zia's village. I could just keep my mouth shut. That would be the selfish thing. It might even be the right thing, as I needed his help, and I couldn't afford to have him distracted. But I couldn't keep it from him. I'd invaded his mind and learned his secret name. The least I could do was be honest with him. Carter, there's something else. Set wanted you to know. Zia's village was named Al-Hamra Makan. Carter turned a bit green again. You just forgot to mention this? Remember, Set is a liar, I said. He wasn't being helpful. He volunteered the information because he wanted to cause chaos between us. I could already tell I was losing him. His mind was caught in a strong current that had been pulling him along since January. The idea that he could save Zia. Now that I'd been in his mind, I knew he wouldn't rest. He couldn't rest until he'd found her. It went far beyond liking the girl. He'd convinced himself she was part of his destiny. One of his darker secrets? Deep down, Carter still resented our father for failing to save our mum, even though she had died for a noble cause, and even though it was her choice to sacrifice herself. Carter simply could not fail Zia in the same way, no matter what the stakes. He needed someone to believe in him, someone to save, and he was convinced Zia was that person. Sorry, a little sister just wouldn't do. It hurt me, especially since I didn't agree with him, but I knew better than to argue. It would only push him farther away. Al-Hamra Makan, he said. My Arabic isn't very good, but Makan is red.
Yes, Bess agreed. Al-Hamra means the sands.
Carter's eyes widened.
The place of red sands. The voice at the Brooklyn Museum said Zia was asleep at the place of red sands. He looked at me pleadingly. Sadie, it's the ruins of her home village. That's where Iskander hid her. We have to find her.
Just like that, the fate of the world goes out the window. We have to find Zia. I could have pointed out several things. He was going on the word of an evil spirit that was probably speaking directly from Apophis. If Apophis knew where Zia was kept, why would he tell us except to delay and distract us? And if he wanted Zia dead, why hadn't he killed her already? Also, Set had given us the name Al-Hamra Makan. Set was never up to any good. He was clearly hoping to divide us. Finally, even if we had the name of the village, that didn't mean we could find it. The place had been wiped out almost a decade ago. But looking at Carter, I realized there was no reasoning with him. This wasn't a reasonable choice. He saw a chance to save Zia, and he was going to take it. I simply said, "It's a bad idea." And yes, it felt quite strange being forced to play the responsible sibling. Carter turned to Bess.
"Could you find this village?"
The dwarf god tugged at his Hawaiian shirt.
Maybe, but it would take time. You've got a little more than 2 days left. The equinox starts the day after tomorrow at sunset. Getting to the oasis of Baharia is a full day of travel. Finding this ruined village, easily another day. And if it's on the Nile, it's in the opposite direction. Once you've got the Book of Ra, you'll need to allow another day at least to figure out how to use it. I guarantee awakening Ra will mean a trip into the Duat, where time is always unpredictable. You'll have to be back with Ra at dawn on the equinox.
We don't have enough time, I summed up. It's either the Book of Ra or Zia. Why did I press Carter when I knew what he was going to say? I can't leave her. He looked at the sun, now dipping toward the horizon.
She's got a part to play, Sadie. I don't know what it is, but she's important. We can't lose her.
I waited. It was obvious what had to happen, but Carter wasn't going to say it. I took a deep breath. We'll have to separate. You and Bess go after Zia. I'll track down the scroll. Bess coughed.
Speaking of bad ideas...
Carter couldn't look me in the eyes. I knew he cared about me. He didn't want to be rid of me, but I could sense his relief. He wanted to be released from his responsibilities so he could hunt down Zia. You saved my life, he said. I can't let you go alone into the desert. I unclasped my Shen necklace. I won't go alone. Wart offered to help.
He can't,
Bess said. But you won't tell me why, I said. Bess faltered.
Look, I promised Bast I'd watch you, keep you safe.
And I expect you to watch Carter very well. He'll need you to find this village. As for me, Walt and I can manage.
But
whatever Walt's bloody secret is, whatever you're trying to protect him from, it's making him miserable. He wants to help, and I'm going to let him. The dwarf glared at me, possibly wondering if he could yell boo and win the argument. I suppose he realized I was too stubborn. He sighed in resignation.
Two young people traveling alone through Egypt, a boy and a girl? It'll look strange.
I'll just say Walt's my brother. Carter winced. I hadn't meant to be harsh, but I suppose the comment was a bit hurtful. Looking back, I'm sorry for that, but at the time I was terrified and angry. Carter was putting me in an impossible position. Go, I said firmly. Save Zia. Carter tried to read my expression, but I avoided looking at him. This was not the time for us to have one of our silent conversations. He didn't really want to know what I was thinking. How will we find each other? He asked. Let's meet back here, I suggested. We'll leave at dawn. Allow ourselves 24 hours, no longer, for me to find the scroll, you to find Zia's village, and both of us to get back to Alexandria. Bess grunted.
Not enough time. Even if everything goes perfectly, that'll leave you about 12 hours to put together the Book of Ra and use it before the eve of the equinox.
He was right. It was impossible. Yet Carter nodded. It's our only chance. We have to try. He looked at me hopefully, but I think I knew even then that we wouldn't meet in Alexandria. We were the Canes, which meant everything would go wrong. Fine, I muttered. Now, if you'll excuse me, I should go pack. I walked inside before I could start crying.
13. I get a demon up my nose. At this point, I should change my secret name to Embarrassed to Death by Sister, because that pretty much sums up my existence. I'm going to skip over our travel preparations, how Sadie summoned Walt and explained the situation, how Bess and I said our farewells at dawn and rented a car from one of Bess's reliable friends, and how that car broke down halfway to Cairo. Basically, I'm going to skip to the part where Bess and I were rumbling along a dusty road in the back of a pickup truck, driven by some Bedouins, looking for a village that no longer existed. By this point, it was late afternoon, and I was starting to think Bess's estimate of needing one day to find Alhamra Makan was way too optimistic. With each hour we wasted, my heart felt heavier. I'd risked everything to help Zia. I'd left Amos and our initiates alone at Brooklyn House to defend against the most evil magician in the world. I'd left my sister to continue the quest for the last scroll without me. If I failed to find Zia, well, I couldn't fail. Traveling with professional nomads had some advantages. For one thing, the Bedouins knew every village, farm, and dusty crossroads in Egypt. They were happy to stop and ask the locals about the vanished village we were seeking. For another thing, the Bedouins revered Bess. They treated him as a living good luck charm. When we stopped for lunch, which took 2 hours to make, the Bedouins even gave us the best part of the goat. As far as I could tell, the best part of the goat wasn't too different from the worst part of the goat, but I suppose it was a big honor. The bad thing about traveling with Bedouins? They weren't in a hurry. It took us all day to wind our way south along the Nile Valley. The journey was hot and boring. In the back of the truck, I couldn't even talk to Bess without getting a mouthful of sand, so I had way too much time to think. Sadie described my obsession pretty well. The moment she'd given me the name of Zia's village, I couldn't focus on anything else. Of course, I figured it was some sort of trick. Apophis was trying to divide us and keep us from succeeding on our quest. But I also believed he was telling the truth, if only because the truth is what would rattle me the most. He had destroyed Zia's village when she was a child. For what reason, I didn't know. Now she was hidden there in a magic sleep. Unless I saved her, Apophis would kill her. Why hadn't he killed her already if he knew where she was? I wasn't sure. And that bothered me. Maybe he didn't have the power yet. Maybe he didn't want to. After all, if he was trying to lure me into a trap, she was the best bait. Whatever the case, Sadie was right. It wasn't a rational choice for me. I had to save Zia. Despite that, I felt like a creep for leaving Sadie on her own yet again. First, I'd let her go off to London, even though I knew it was a bad idea. Now I'd sent her to track down a scroll in a catacomb full of mummies. Sure, Walt would help her, and she could usually take care of herself, but a good brother would have stayed with her. Sadie had just saved my life, and I was like, great, see you later, have fun with the mummies.
I'll just say Walt is my brother.
Ouch. If I'm honest with myself, Zia wasn't the only reason I was anxious to go off on my own. I was in shock that Sadie had discovered my secret name. Suddenly, she knew me better than anyone in the world. I felt like she'd opened me up on the surgery table, examined me, and sewn me back together. My first instinct was to run away, to put as much distance between us as possible. I wondered if Ra had felt the same way when Isis learned his name, if that was the real reason he went into exile, complete humiliation. Also, I needed time to process what Sadie had accomplished. For months, we'd been trying to relearn the path of the gods. We'd struggled to figure out how the ancient magicians tapped the gods' powers without getting possessed or overwhelmed. Now I suspected Sadie had found the answer. It had something to do with a god's wren. A secret name wasn't just a name, like a magic word. It was the sum of the god's experiences. The more you understood the god, the closer you got to knowing their secret name, and the more you could channel their power. If that was true, then the path of the gods was basically sympathetic magic. Finding a similarity between two things, like a regular corkscrew and a corkscrew-headed demon, and using that similarity to form a magic bond. Only here, the bond was between the magician and a god. If you could find a common trait or experience, you could tap the god's power. That might explain how I'd blasted open the doors at the Hermitage with the Fist of Horus, a spell I'd never been able to do on my own. Without thinking about it, without needing to combine souls with Horus, I'd tapped into his emotions. We both hated feeling confined. I'd used that simple connection to invoke a spell and break the chains. Now, if I could just figure out how to do stuff like that more reliably, it might save us in the coming battles. We traveled for miles in the Bedouin's truck. The Nile snaked through green and brown fields to our left. We had nothing to drink but water from an old plastic jug that tasted like Vaseline. The goat meat wasn't sitting well in my stomach. Every once in a while, I'd remember the poison that had coursed through my body, and my shoulder would start to ache where the Chesu Hiru had bitten me. Around 6 in the evening, we got our first lead. An old fellaheen, a peasant farmer selling dates on the roadside, said he knew the village we were seeking. When he heard the name, Al Hamra Makan, he made a protective sign against the evil eye. But since Bess was the one asking, the old man told us what he knew. He said Red Sands was an evil place, very badly cursed. No one ever visited nowadays. But the old man remembered the village from before it had been destroyed. We would find it 10 kilometers south, at a bend in the river where the sand turned bright red. Well, duh, I thought, but I couldn't help being excited. The Bedouins decided to make camp for the night. They wouldn't be going with us the rest of the way, but they said they'd be honored if Bess and I borrowed their truck. A few minutes later, Bess and I were cruising along in the pickup. Bess wore a floppy hat almost as ugly as his Hawaiian shirt. It was pulled so low I wasn't sure he could see anything, especially since he was barely eye level with the dashboard. Every time we hit a bump, Bedouin trinkets jangled on the rearview mirror. A metal disc etched with Arabic calligraphy, a Christmas tree-shaped pine air freshener, some animal teeth on a leather strap, and a little icon of Elvis Presley, for reasons I didn't understand. The truck had no suspension and hardly any padding on the seats. I felt like I was riding a mechanical bull. Even without the jostling, my stomach would have been upset. After months of searching and hoping, I couldn't believe I was so close to finding Zia.
"You look terrible," Bess said.
"Thanks."
"I mean, magically speaking. You don't look ready for a fight. Whatever's waiting for us, you understand it isn't going to be friendly."
Under the brim of his hat, his jaw jutted out like he was bracing for an argument. "You think this is a mistake," I said. "You think I should have stayed with Sadie?" He shrugged.
"I think if you were looking at it straight, you'd see this has trap written all over it. The old chief lector, Iskander, wouldn't have hidden your girlfriend..."
"She's not my girlfriend."
"...without putting some protective spells around her. Set and Apophis, apparently both, want you to find this place, which means it cannot be good for you. You're leaving your sister and Walt on their own. On top of all that, we're traipsing through Desjardins' backyard, and after that stunt in St. Petersburg, Menshikov won't rest until he finds you. So yeah, I'd say this isn't your brightest idea."
I stared out the windshield. I wanted to be mad at Bess for calling me stupid, but I was afraid he might be right. I'd been hoping for a happy reunion with Zia. The chances were I'd never make it through tonight alive. "Maybe Menshikov is still recovering from his head injuries," I said hopefully. Bess laughed.
"Take it from me, kid. Menshikov is already after you. He never forgets an insult."
His voice smoldered with anger, like it did in St. Petersburg when he told us about the dwarf wedding. I wondered what had really happened to Bess in that palace, and why he was still brooding over it 300 years later. "Was it Vlad?" I asked. "Was he the one who captured you?" It didn't seem so far-fetched. I'd met several magicians who were centuries old. But Bess shook his head.
"His grandfather, Prince Alexander Menshikov."
Bess said the name like it was a major insult.
"He was secretly the head of the 18th gnome. Powerful. Cruel. A lot like his grandson. I'd never dealt with a magician like that. It was the first time I'd been captured."
"But didn't the magicians lock all you gods in the Duat after Egypt fell?"
"Most of us,"
Bess agreed.
"Some slept the entire 2 millennia until your dad unleashed us. Others broke out from time to time, and the House of Life would track them down and put them back. Sekhmet broke out in 1918, big influenza epidemic. But a few of the gods like me stayed in the mortal world the entire time. Back in the ancient days, I was just, you know, a friendly guy. I scared away spirits. The commoners liked me. So when Egypt fell, the Romans adopted me as one of their gods. Then, in the Middle Ages, the Christians modeled gargoyles after me to protect their cathedrals and whatnot. They made up legends about gnomes, dwarves, helpful leprechauns, all based on me."
"Helpful leprechauns?" He scowled.
"You don't think I'm helpful? I look good in green tights."
"I didn't need that image," Bess huffed.
"Anyway, the House of Life was never serious about tracking me down. I just kept a low profile and stayed out of trouble. I was never captured until Russia. Probably still be a prisoner there if it wasn't for..."
He stopped himself as if realizing he'd said too much. He turned off the road. The truck rattled over hard-packed sand and rocks heading for the river. "Someone helped you escape?" I guessed. "Bost?" The dwarf's neck turned bright red.
"No.
not Bast. She was stuck in the abyss fighting Apophis.
Then...
The point is, I got free, and I got my revenge. I managed to get Alexander Menshikov convicted on corruption charges. He was disgraced, stripped of his wealth and titles. His whole family was shipped off to Siberia. Best day of my life. Unfortunately, his grandson, Vladimir, made a comeback. Eventually, he moved back to St. Petersburg, rebuilt his grandfather's fortune, and took over the 18th gnome. If Vlad had the chance to capture me...
Bess shifted in the driver's seat, like the spring...